Somewhere in the universe, there has to be something better than man.
Don't look for it, Taylor. You may not like what you find.
From this day forward, my people will plan for the inevitable day of man's downfall. And that day is upon you now!
It's a man out!
Greetings, fellow enjoyers of the future of missing pets and ape servants. I am your host, JonesCat79, aka Christo, my usual co-host, Derek, aka Dark Neon.
We've warned you, and now the day is upon you all, now!
Yes, so we're back with one of these other ape discussions after we did the last one, which some of you who are paying attention at home are going, but wait, didn't we end the franchise on two movies? Like, they blew up the earth in the first one. But if you think that was the end, oh, you are terribly naive, because as we all know, no ultimate destruction, no universal clash, no powerful weapon, no divinity stopping entity can stop the almighty power of the dollar.
And plus, it's always fun to take a trip down to everyone's favorite science fiction trope, time travel!
What? I see this as an absolute win. I had to. But yeah, so, as we said, that was the start of a franchise, and the franchise went into other directions, because, you know, Fox and AP Jacobs Productions knew when they had a good thing going, well, no need to stop a good thing from going, but I think they took the criticisms of the last one to heart, because they went in interesting directions and managed to keep the same writer for most of these, but they managed to, like, improve upon the latter. So you can argue the earlier ones. You could argue that this is a series that only got improved at the entry for the entries for the most part, something that would be consistent with the franchise as a whole, where if they have a good foundation, they just only continue to build on it in interesting and better ways. I mean, Beneath was, pardon the phrase, beneath the scopes of the original Planet of the Apes, but it still went in interesting directions, such as exploring the ideas of what evolved humanity would still remain be like. You know, they end up worshipping the weapon that would be their ultimate destruction, and how would the apes feel about, you know, finding another civilization besides them? So,
obviously, and also, also implanting the seeds that, even though the most sacred law is ape shall not kill ape, it doesn't mean there isn't discord among certain ape types, most especially with the brutish gorillas.
Well, you saw that in the first movie when they're talking about how all apes were created equal in the eyes of their creator, and Taylor remarks, well, some are more equal than most, which they took objection to. But yeah, so I think that they probably heard that that Beneath was too weird and too bleak. I mean, come on, you shoot our heroes, turn them into Swiss cheese at the end, both of them. You have, like it says, apes.
Brent got it the worst, though.
Yeah.
Like, my God.
Oh, one thing I kept seeing in videos about that scene was, poor Brent, he just came to rescue, him, and then this happened. Notice that he went down fighting after Taylor had bought it, because he at least got a good shot on Ursus before he ended up, you know, biting the big one.
Yeah, it's very true.
But yeah, so anyway, one thing about, before we go into the sequels, I wanted to point out the bit that I've neglected to mention at all when talking about.
Oh, yes. I kicked you for that one.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
No, it's the you neglected to talk about the soundtrack before. I mean, goodness sakes, you blasted it and blared it across all these intros for heaven knows. It's kind of hard to ignore that, so.
Well, yes. Proceed. Jerry Goldsmith's fantastic score for the original Planet of the Apes, which, unfortunately, is so good that other scores in the franchise don't quite live up to it, I feel, personally.
Maybe Conquest.
Well, yeah, but it did borrow a few cues from it. I mean, the closest you get to it is probably in Escape and, I guess, the Conquest. But the funny thing about it is that like I said, there's a little strange thing about it, in my view, is that they found a way to, like, Jerry Goldsmith always experiments with his instruments. He always likes to take them into weird and interesting directions. And one thing he did with this one was he made a lot of instruments that kind of made the soundtrack itself make simian noises, if you noticed. Like, it almost sounds like a monkey's war cry or a monkey's little hook, hook, like, with the little way the rhythms move. So, it had a lot of percussion, a lot of, like, bone percussion, a lot of, like, conches. Like, during the hunt, there is this big moment where, when they reveal the apes, they blow through a conch horn, and you get that little dissident chord that goes, like, whoop, like, you hear that, to really hit home that, what the fuck, is that monkey riding on the back of the horse?
Yep.
But, yeah, so I wanted to mention that was one thing that I thought Jerry Goldsmith did very well, is that he made the soundtrack, you know, discordant, but not in a, I'm smashing keys randomly, like, you know, apes behind a typewriter. No, he actually, like, says there was a method to his madness, and all of his scores, his most epics to his most terrifying, all have some sort of experimentation that only adds more flavor to the movies. I mean, one not need look far than his contributions to stuff like Richard Donner's The Omen, or Ridley Scott's Alien, my personal favorite, as you can probably guess. Hell, even his score in Small Soldiers captured the feeling of that movie very well by having this militaristic march for the commandos paired up with this almost whimsical E.T.-like score for the Gorgonites. Yeah, but anyway, okay, I just wanted to let that part go. I slapped myself. After I ended the recording, I went, oh, crap, we didn't talk about the music. But now that we've talked about the music, I think we can go ahead and say, yeah, we decided that we'll do another Apes movie, even though it we blew the fuck out of the earth with the Alpha and Omega bomb. A bomb that is so baffling to Derek that why that would...
It's baffling because how would they even know it would work? I mean, yeah, Oppenheimer assumed that would be the reaction when he made and tested his bomb, but the thing is, he still tested the bomb.
Well, the thing is,
it still ignited it.
I think the idea is that cobalt is much more stronger and much more, you know, the fission from that would make a huger chain reaction possibly. And they said it was a cobalt bomb instead of a uranium or plutonium bomb or hydrogen bomb. So, yeah.
Even then, you still gotta test the damn thing. You can't just assume your science is gonna be right.
I still find it funny that Fox said, "Hey, this movie still made bangers, so we're still gonna make a sequel." Hell, so apparently Paul Den, the writer, got a telegram about the sequel saying, "Apes exist, sequel required." So he had to find a way to get out of the fact that we blew up the Earth. Hell, they even had a lot of concepts to play with the whole going back to where Taylor came from, or even going further, like, they mentioned that Milo, the third ape in the thing, was like the Leonardo da Vinci of his time. But, what's great about this is that, they found it out with time travel, of course. Even though this is a smaller budget, because they only have to really worry about two apes instead of a whole city. Well, three, it's at the beginning, but yeah. And you can definitely tell that when you see another animal that's in this thing that made Derek laugh every time they cut to the damn thing.
Oh my god, the fucking gorilla.
But yeah, so smaller budget. Apparently, Kim Hunter had to be really talked into to join Beneath, but this one was very enticing to her. On top of that, it ended in a way that made her say, "If I just got to do this one more and not have to worry about any makeup ever again." But more, she was also in love with the idea of the script. On top of that, I'd argue this one has much more of Zira in it than the previous two did.
And the first one already had plenty of Zira in it.
Oh yeah, it did. But you know, her and Cornelius were pretty much cameos in Beneath.
If you even call that Cornelius. But thankfully, that mistake has been rectified as Roddy McDowall actually did return, finally, because his schedule was freed up.
Uh-huh. So, but he also, like, I mentioned that maybe people thought that Beneath was too bleak because Escape from the Planet of the Apes is a weird one. Not in a bad way, but it's got this funny thing where it has a tone.
Oh, it starts whimsical. Like, yeah, actually, I didn't mentioned this while we were watching it, rewatching it, but the opening almost felt like it was the opening to like a comedy show or something,
or like Mel Brooks's Planet of the Apes or something, right?
Yeah, something like that. But it opened like an old fashioned TV show where it's like you pan to one and then you have like the actor's name on the bottom and then pan to the next that actor then. Just pan to the next, you know, those types of openings.
Holy moly, this movie was only filmed in 6 weeks, and given the quality of the film we got, I'd say that was actually pretty well. So, Escape from the Planet of the Apes is kind of funny, because they escape from their timeline and their planet, and end up back in the present day at the time, which was the 70s, you know, where Taylor had, you know, taken off. And
although, I do have to tilt my head, it's like, how, though?
Well, like I said...
I know they they show and explain, but literally, how did, because, okay, so just bear with me here as I try to explain this tattered weave of complete plot hole knots we have here. So, in the first movie, it's kind of, like, stated that apes do not believe that, like, flight or anything of that notion is possible. Shit, they don't even think space travel is, like, a thing.
Yeah, every time Taylor mentioned he was from another planet, they kept on, like, telling him, like, nonsense. Preposterous.
And so, also, not only did one ship crash, you have two ship crashes. And bear in mind, I'm pretty sure that these are, like, one part of a ship, so the ignition isn't as full as it should be. So even if they did manage to refit the ship in the second one, to fly, they wouldn't probably get that far. They would probably have run out of fuel before they could even get the time travel notion to start. But even then, they don't even know how to fly the damn thing, or even understand how to work that.
Well, I think that they wrote it out with their third compatriot, Milo, who was described as the Da Vinci of his time. I'm sure his ideas of flight and machinery were considered radical, maybe even heresy, by the defenders of the faith and such. So now that, you know, Isaias is too busy having his hands full dealing with the guerrilla war machine, I'm sure that gave Milo plenty of time to believe. I'm sure he overheard the testimony about where Taylor came from and where he was in the Forbidden Zone and stuff. So,
and now here's the bigger one, though. How did they know that ship was there?
Well, I guess because Taylor...
How?
Don't forget.
How, though?
Taylor insisted in his writings to Zira and Cornelius that he was found in that spot of the Forbidden Zone.
No, I'm not talking about the one that sank. I'm talking about the one that was dry, that they could actually fly.
No, the one that they picked was the one that sank. They pulled it out of the water, because the one that crashed on Brent's thing was completely smashed to shit when it crashed.
Okay, that makes even less sense, because, like... But whatever, I guess if, like, even Luke's X-Wing can be still flyable after being submerged for God knows how long, I'm sure we could manage to fly it half of a ship.
But, yeah.
So, a ship that doesn't have any, like, supported infrastructure because, like, the glass pane windows are cracked. No! This is on wire, like, way too much. I'm starting to think, and it's completely, okay. Like, that
doesn't make any
point
sense.
Point is, they salvaged Taylor's ship. They were testing it around the upper atmosphere when all of a sudden the whole planet blew up, and that knocked them off course and sent them through a wormhole or whatever that sent them, spat them out on the other end of time, where they ended up crashing. I think the ship still had... The reason it crashed in the water probably in the year 3000-something is because maybe it had a guidance system and it still took it back home, like, you know, like salmon spawning and everything. So maybe that's why it still crashed in the sea when they landed back in San Francisco. But, you know, like I said, I do find it funny that Zira and Cornelius and Milo are wearing the spacesuits. Like, I don't know that Taylor and the rest had extra suits on that thing.
And why do they think they would need to wear those suits?
I don't know. It makes for a cool reveal when the military thinks they got a recovering spacecraft and they go, they're ready to welcome whoever it is on the other end, and then all of a sudden they see chimp faces underneath the helmets. It makes for a great reveal.
Also, did the time travel involve them having to go into hibernation like the humans did? How would they know that would work?
Well, I don't think they were... Well, they knew enough to pack because Zira had her little bag with their change of clothes and everything. Yeah, but point is...
Dude, the more we think about it, the more I'm pretty sure this is probably the stupidest movie in the franchise.
Well, it gets better. It gets better despite us arguing about the...
It was just the only point of a few points, but the more I thought about it, the more I realized, oh my god, why does it just keep getting worse and worse and worse and worse? Why is this, like, the biggest plot hole of this entire franchise?
Oh, no, it gets even weirder. Yeah, so, like I said, anyway, they end up in present-day, Earth, and the military... Oh, this... Actually, Derek was already incredulous from the beginning, just from the fact that once the apes showed themselves, the soldiers didn't think to, shoot it.
Yeah.
He said that right away on the viewing, like, huh, this is already unrealistic. The military didn't bother to shoot the damn things while they freaked out at the sudden, you know, ape. And I said, maybe they figured this was one of their own test apes shot in the space finally come back. Because some of them didn't come down. I mean, do you remember the story of old Cosmo, the cosmonaut that ended up in the collector's collection?
Well, see, the difference being, that's a dog.
Oh, imagine how they deal with the... Well, anyway, going back to the... Yeah, so... yeah, what's funny is they do find themselves in a sort of reverse situation of what Taylor went through. About them being in the cage and being observed and poked and prodded at by people. Only the scientists here are definitely much more curious and a little more humane because they don't go quick to, like, you know, spraying them. So they do the simple basic test, and of course Zira kind of plays along of like, okay, this is simple. And eventually she just couldn't hold it in and she speaks, which shocks them. It's not quite as
Tell them why she spoke.
Oh, yes.
Because, especially since Milo explicitly said, like, okay, so what I'm gathering here is that we must have been shot back to the time where your friend Taylor seemed to have come from, where, according to him, humans were the dominant species, not us, and that we didn't speak. So until we could actually figure out what to do, we're going to remain silent.
Yeah, apes.
Keep our yap shut, okay?
Like, apes speak up here. Here, apes don't speak. And she was playing with the test, and they kept on being curious about her. There's a point where one of the tests includes dropping a banana from the roof. And, that
fucking banana.
And then she's looking at it, and she does a test that she's able to reach it, but she chooses not to. Even the scientist, psychiatrist Stevie, played by...
Why does she reach for the banana?
Because I absolutely loathe bananas, she says in clear English with them. Even Cornelius is all zero. Like, and of course, Stevie takes it about as well as you expect. She faints. But yeah, but they point out where, yeah, that I brought up the banana bit because I'm pretty sure they wrote that in for Kim Hunter, because as I mentioned before, during the production of the original movie, some of the other cast and crew that weren't apes would kind of taunt the ape crew members with bananas. And she came to, I mean, she never liked them that much to begin with, but I think that just made her sick. Yeah, yeah, fuck bananas.
Which is also kind of a little bit of a speciesist, too, since gorillas aren't that fond of bananas. They're more into other fruits. I think they're into more melons, I think.
Yeah, I believe so, too. So, I know we say, you mentioned three apes. How can you keep bringing up with two main apes? Well, because, sadly, Milo doesn't stick around long. They're like they move him to the zoo, and there's this god-awful costume of a gorilla sitting next to them at the press gorilla they had.
Jesus Christ, the gorilla from that SpongeBob episode was more believable than this.
I know, it just looks very, very goofy, like extremely goofy. But yeah, and I mean, especially when you pair it up next to the human ape makeup, you go like, damn. But, it ends up killing him, and the funny backstory behind that, I hear, is that because the fellow behind the makeup, Milo...
Just couldn't do it! He just couldn't do it!
Yeah, yeah, he was played also, by Sal Mineo.
Also, he had claustrophobia.
Yeah, Sal Mineo, he did play him for a little while, and I guess he just couldn't keep up with the makeup and stuff, and like I said, it was claustrophobia, so yeah. So, I think he just asked him, you know, just write me out a picture as fast as you can. So, he ended up being a surprise casualty to say that, yeah, even in the past, this is dangerous. Plus, I'm pretty sure that the military dissected his remains and found an advanced vocal system and brain area. Much like what Zira and the apes tried to do to people in their time when they would find them. Let's take a look at the speech areas and the brain to see if there's any chances of the humans having a link between the simian nature of them and them. So, you know, it goes from that to a political inquiry, which I imagine after the McCarthy era, this must have been rather fun to, like, kind of mirror that. But, you know, it's a little more even-handed than that kangaroo court Taylor went through with Zayas and his council.
Yeah, unfortunately, we are spared of the judges not doing the iconic "hear no evil, see no evil, speak no evil" sign.
But yeah, like I said, it's very funny how Dick Professor.
Although I have to say something. I think this is another plot hole because maybe I didn't listen to all of it, but I was pretty sure I was paying attention in the original movies that the apes in the future don't believe there's any history before, like, their dominance. Like, they think that humans have always been dumb. They cannot talk. They never could talk. They never can talk. They never will talk.
That ape evolved from man.
Yeah. But apparently, Cornelius brings out this detailed list of how this future actually happens. And I'm going like, hold the fuck up.
That's what I was going to...
Where did this history come from?
That's what I was going to mention when we get to the later part. But yeah, but we get the initial political inquiry where they're asking about, do you talk? And then they decide to think, maybe they just taught them parroted speech. Just like how, you know, they thought Taylor was just being taught simple tricks when he was doing his human behavior. Oh, by the way, we're joined by our usual other associate of the show, Ian, Werewolf River, in the chat. Hi, Ian. And I understand you told me this was one of your first and favorite of the classic ape movies aside from the originals. So we're talking about it now, and I don't know if you came in earlier, but Derek was actually trying to dissect the whole... They found the ship somehow. I can't figure
out the ship! The ship is the most convoluted fucking, like, mind-boggling thing about this entire franchise. I was able to let it slip by while we were watching it, but the more I think about it while we're talking about this, the more it just breaks my brain to think that...
But yeah, anyway, so it's very funny how the public is quick to like embrace the two intelligent, friendly apes who come in peace, even though Zira, being a little more outspoken, nearly lets slip a few details that might not make the Earth too friendly to them. Or even knowing about this Sergeant Taylor's, ship, because that was his shuttle. And then, Cornelius tells them, yeah, we don't know this soldier of yours, but when he talks to Dixon and Stevie, he says, well, actually, yes, we did know Taylor. But that leads to a natural question. Well, is Taylor's still alive, and they're like, he can't be given what we saw. Given what we saw. Because they said that, should we tell them that their destiny is that one day they'll watch their planet crack like an egg from their own weapon? Like, it's already hard enough buying talking apes for the committee, but how are you going to tell them, we're from a future where you guys are our slaves, and one day you guys will blow up the entire Earth, causing the destruction of both species? That wouldn't fly over so well in a congressional committee, I tell you what.
Sorry, hold on. Sorry, what was the question again?
Oh, yeah. Talking about how they were quick to talk about, they omitted information willingly during the tribunal because, like, how would they accept the idea of, oh, yeah, we come in a future where we hunted you guys for sports, and you guys were our slaves, and one day you guys will blow up the entire planet, wiping out both our species. How do you like that?
Well, wait a sec. You know, if you had told me this in 1973, I would have, like, thought you were just be crazy. But nowadays,
oh, yeah.
Tell me the when and why.
Yeah, so it's funny. After the congressional hearing, it does take a turn for the more humorous and rather whimsical, where, like, they take the apes around the city on tours. They let them shop for human clothes. They ask them fun questions at societal parties. They introduce them to wine, which they call Grape Juice Plus. And it's all that stuff that you see in the trailers. You think, oh, this is going to be a fun little farce. Like, a fun little, you know, like, send-up after all the gloom and death and mutations and wars and hunting we saw in the last twos. A little change of pace that you would think, oh, well, fans would probably hate this because, oh, this is betraying everything that came before. God forbid anything that started out serious end up being fun and lighthearted, as we're hearing complaints about these days.
Yeah, it would be. If it were for one specific teeny tiny little splinter of a character that is in this movie that decides to be such an asshole.
Dr. Otto Haslin, played by Eric Braeden, who is the one guy who is already, like, he buys their story immediately that they're from the future. But he was very quick to catch that there's some things are omitting, and when he even asked him, like, what do you expect from this congressional hearing, he says, fear. Like, he's already a guy who's already socially conscious about, you know, presidential's society, you know, scientist advisor, so I'm sure he has an eye to the future.
Why do I get the feeling that he's still shaking off the whole, like, coming red fear phase of history?
Probably. I mean, with a name like Haslin, he's probably not, you know, he probably was subject to McCarthy inquiries, but I don't know. So the thing is, he is the only one that has, like, wariness of the apes and their story. So, of course, under you know, unconventional techniques, he manages to get Zero to spill the beans that she does come from the far-off future, and that the world that she saw, you know, is destroyed. So he goes, well, who destroyed it? And she's like, well, it was the gorillas. So he's going, well, apes will eventually, you know, dominate us. And if we let them do it, we'll have a war that will eventually destroy the entire planet. So I think that kind of thing frightens him so much it drives him mad. But he tries to say he's actually the most sanest of everybody. Everybody's gone mad, you know, falling for the apes and, you know, treating them like, oh, they're a fun little novelty. But he's thinking they pose a very real threat. Suppose one of their offspring mates with a regular gorilla or a regular chimp, and that chimp ends up producing an ape capable of learning in another generation, and then another generation, eventually leading to a smart society of apes that would eventually supersede man as the controlling interest of the planet.
So what Haslin has deduced is that the world will be destroyed by fairyism?
That's not too far off for how some people believe the world will end, for some, if you bring up anthropomorphic foxes to them.
But even then, I'm pretty sure that Haslin should know that there's at least one big step that does lead into this future he's fearing. The humans have to do the big to-do first. You know, war, the big kaboom,
yeah,
all that nonsense.
Because he said that,
Summit kaput and all that.
He actually tells the president that he got more info, and then the president even says, if you can prove that these apes actually do mean us some harm or have harmed people in our time, I'll give you, I'll willingly give you a year. But even the president says, this is a delicate situation. The public loves them. And it's not good for poll numbers if you take the latest, you know, national sensation and decide to publicly hang them because one of your guys said, oh, they're heresy or whatever.
Oh my God, this really is, feels like it's from a different century altogether.
Yeah, so the president has a little more sense than most political leaders I see in this type of situation. In fact, I don't mean to bemoan real life stuff, but it's always fun and also a little more heartbreaking these days when you actually see a president in a sci-fi movie make more sense than the actual politicians of today. Where if had this happened today, you know right away they would string up those apes without even letting them utter up a word.
We don't need yuppies in our time. Get them out of here! String them up by their toes! Finger palm things.
Yes.
Whatever the fuck monkeys have.
So, anyway, and on top of that, things get more complicated when, during the visit, Zira faints, revealing that she has been pregnant since before Taylor's time. So, I think she was pregnant before Taylor's arrival. Either that or she was, they've been on Earth.
So now we have yet another big thing that just makes me shake my head a little bit. So the baby managed to travel through ignition.
Well,
I need to let this one go because it's doing my mind. You do know astronauts have to be prepared and fit to handle the G-force to even exit our atmosphere, alone go through the whole rigmarole of whatever it caused for them to do their timey-wimey bullshit. And you're telling me that this little chimp managed to live through all that, did not become a little platter of mush throughout all this?
Well, I could be making assumptions. Maybe they were on Earth longer than I realized, and because there is that scene where Cornelius is in the hotel, and maybe Taylor's spaceship is built in such a way.
Just stop. We reached the breaking point. This is the dumbest of the bunch of the Planet of the Apes movies. But unfortunately, it's the big crux of all the how the stories progresses. So
I know.
Off
but,
we go, I guess.
Yeah, like then how can they still have babies in Star Trek while they're on the Enterprise going through space?
Well, it looks like Ian's got a solution. It's a more advanced ship. It has a gravity drive. Well, whoop-dee-ta-do. There's still all the gray areas that we need to discuss.
I mean, we're arguing realism. We're talking apes sort of thing. It's like arguing about Superman's ship saying, the Phantom Drive should have turned Clark into mush, even if he is Kryptonian, because he's still in the red sun gravity when he's being blasted off of Krypton. He doesn't get the yellow sun until he lands on Earth, but we accept the fact that the ship was built to accommodate
him.
Yeah,
but here's
the
thing, though. Here's the thing, though. At least he got shipped off in a ship that his dad built, B, his dad set the coordinates to send him off to, C, made it so that Clark could actually travel in safety because he's that type of a dad, and fourth, it's a superhero mythos!
Yeah, like I said, okay. I think the crystal pinata has much more stability than the 72 rocket that crashed into the water. Okay, I'll give you that. That was a tangent.
Where the hell are we after before? Zia finds out she's pregnant.
And
congratulations, you got knocked up.
And Heslon sees that as the ultimate threat. So he decides to take on the role of the Terminator about a decade earlier and decide that in order to save humanity's future, he must have that baby, you know, aborted, and they must, you know, sterilize the apes so that no chance of them causing a future ape apocalypse would ever happen.
And that's pretty much the point of no return for this guy to be even redeemed or made to understand. He is quick to go for the shoot the monkey.
Well, heck, yeah.
Harambe fans be damned on this guy.
And On top of that, it is here where they do a second inquiry and they realize that Zira and Cornelius did lie about Colonel Taylor. So they go ahead and talk about how, yes, we knew Taylor and that Cornelius had access to some further secret scrolls to talk about how, yes, man and ape did live together at one point, but they were subjugated. And it was not until one such ape stood up against them and uttered a single word that's always been uttered against them, no, to become an ape that started their downward, you know, their trend towards, you know, supremacy. A date that he mentions is commemorated by his species. So going back to the first movie about how they say ape man has no culture. Oh, shit. Oh, shit. I'm guessing he found all this shit about after Zaius let him in on the loop. I'm sure Zaius says, you know, you couldn't be accessing this stuff due to heresy. I'm pretty sure on the ride back, Cornelius figured, oh, well, if I'm going to get my head chopped off, I might as well read every single scroll. Because it was Zaius who says, read the special scroll where the scroll describes man as always being a problem, as being the devil's pawn and will kill his brother for his land. That sounds like man that does have a history and culture that Zaius is aware of. Because he even said, I've always known about man. So I'm guessing only the higher up orangutans ever got the truth about where they came from and shit. And the chimps were left to dig around in the dirt thinking, oh, well, maybe this might prove stuff about the scrolls. And the Zaius and everyone keeps on hamstringing them in budget and other things, you know, stopping their digs. So they won't find out the absolute truth. Because remember what he says, if Taylor really is from a previous civilization, the sacred scrolls may not be worth the parchment they're printed on.
Except they would be more so solidified. Zaius would literally use this to say, look, see, we have the proof here before you now that this is what will happen to man in their time. Yeah. They would cause the world to burn asunder, but it would be us, the apes, that would bring it back to its former glory.
Mm-hmm.
Nay, a new, prouder glory.
Unfortunately, Ursus was super, let's invade the land and fuck up their big shiny dildo. Which was probably the stupidest mistake Ursus could do. And even as I'm watching them attack the church and they're pulling down the bomb and the radiation's coming out, I'm all like, oops. Oh, it's a gorilla. What do you expect?
So, certain details in Cornelius's history lesson is that this all started because apparently a plague happened that killed all the cats and dogs, and humans got bummed that they don't have pets around, so of course they went with the immediate factor, parakeets. Well, no, they actually went all the way to fucking apes, because, well, we gotta have apes to be, like, servants and do all this stuff for us. It's like, okay, so are they trying to assume that why have you tried to make dogs and cats be our, like, servants or do things like that? I mean, shit, we got dogs that are, like, militarized up and down.
Well, we kind of did, you know, with the bigger dogs, but like I says, cats are just kind of our lap animals, and I guess people miss the companionship, and like I said, they figured out with monkeys that, and apes, that they can learn to actually do stuff, so they figured, well, so that
naturally... I'm just saying, all this shit would have been not happened if they decided to at least embrace taking in hamsters and guinea pigs and Komodo dragons.
For all we know, the plague killed them too, but they left that detail out.
Oh, okay. So pretty much the Earth is a void of all other animal creature life except humans and all apes.
And horses. Course. And don't forget the horses.
Yeah, the horses too.
Okay, anyway.
Sure.
Oh, God. It's very funny. So anyway, it turns
out... You know, the more that we peel this movie away, the more it just breaks apart.
Yeah, well, thankfully, the other movies kind of make up for it, so to speak. But, I mean, because I'm guessing the mantra was, do what Irvin and Kershner told Harrison Ford before he said his line reading, where he kept trying too hard to make it work.
Hey, Harrison, don't think about it, let's shoot. Okay, action!
Yeah, so Haslin, yeah, like I says, I love the bit where... he does get more evidence under Truth Serum from Zira, talking about how we did things to humans and we vivisected them, we operated on every part of them. And in the year 31,050, Taylor came to them and they saw the Earth, you know, just get destroyed by the guerrilla war. So that was all the proof he needed for them to say, yeah, the Congressional Committee said, yes, the apes here are peaceful, we do a lot of them, and they shall not be harmed, they'll be allowed to live with us. However, their child should be removed from them, and they will be sterilized to ensure that no further ape uprising could ever happen. So
give them the Bob Barker treatment!
Uh-huh. Spade and neuter your pets, everybody. So, it does... There is a running thing where people keep calling... we kept calling them monkeys, to which even Cornelius is like, please don't use that word. That's, like, demeaning to them. It does get to the point where they want to feed something to Zero that might put her to sleep and might also harm the baby, which she doesn't want to happen. And he keeps saying, this is that little monkey you have in you, and that drives Cornelius enough over the edge to, like, push him with the tray so hard that the guy dies.
Whoops.
So they're definitely on the shooting.
Yeah, that's... I think we were kind of this, like, teetery on the whimsy there, but at that point, that's where, like, okay, all the fun and dandy Disney-fied stuff is done and over with. Now we're gonna get the brass tacks.
It's a proper Apes movie, because you got them on the run. It's like Taylor was on the run. And they only have few human allies, and it's this late in the movie that we meet another human ally that's become a fan favorite, Armando the Circus Owner, played by the great Ricardo Montalban. A.K.A. Khan, A.K.A. Mr. Rourke, A.K.A.
Grandpa Cortez.
Yeah. oh, God.
I really miss those movies.
And, oh, God, Armando is such a breath of fresh air. In fact, it's nice to have someone that's on their side.
Speaking of fresh air, Ian says, it's funny how watching the movie, I didn't even notice these. I guess the emotions are just so powerful that logic is left out the door.
Well, no shit. I'd agree with that assertion.
I can kind of see that. Even Lee Carr talks about, like, where logic goes out the door for some stories like Batman Hush or Infinite Crisis. But it's the spectacle of it is so wowing to you that you just kind of forget about all the stuff that makes you have to think later.
Okay, if you could just entertain this thought a little
here
more.
We go again.
I'm sorry, it's real quick. But I won't turn off my mic, so I won't be silent like the last time. I learned my lesson from that time.
Oh, yeah.
All right, carry on.
So, let's see here. I guess I could try to see if I could peel any more plot holes in this movie. Because, goodness knows, there's plenty. So, I do have to wonder why So, of course, they're on the run due to the fact that Cornelius did a bit of a whoopsie there. And, I can't do it. Let's see. I guess we could find something to discuss. I guess we could kind of discuss about the whole thing that this movie is kind of a really, really weird thing to watch, especially with the fact that Elf is up so happy, even though we literally continue off with the fact that we just saw so many characters we followed and beloved die in gratuitous ways, and we blew up the whole Earth. All kaputsies. And I don't know, I guess the writer did have to try to make it seem a little bit more whimsical to kind of like mellow things up, but even then it kind of also hinders it to the fact that when the bad shit hits, it hits hard. And it probably, I'm honestly surprised it's certain things that happen in this movie that we'll discuss when Jonesy comes back, that this movie still even kept its G rating, because boy, the ratings board must have really been, like, on a bender there to not even care the slightest about the amount of grotesque and dark, bloody imagery that we had to foresee in this movie in particular. especially considering the fact that, oh my god. No, I need to save it. I need to save that part, because that fucking hurts, man. But it's just such a weird franchise that it seems like every time it goes, it gets dark and dark and dark. You think it gets hopeful in certain parts, and it's just such a it seems like it just keeps slapping you in the face to say, no, no hope or happiness. This is a doomed timeline. We are going to kill each other. We're going to bomb ourselves into nothingness. And we're going to do it even again with a stronger bomb that we made out of cobalt for some reason. Because we think we need to go big or go home. It does seem like everything kind of spirals out of control when Hessen just keeps trying to incite. Look, the reason that the future is even happening now is because probably Hessen really got off the deep end and really forced the future. He's become his own preordained destiny for, like, engaged in this. If he had just let the apes go, they probably would have, like, minded their own goddamn business and been off their merry way. Maybe, just maybe, we could have had a different timeline where we had a little bit more forethought to know where we're going. But I guess Hester was under this delusion that, no, once you know the future, you cannot change it. Ugh, God, it sounds like Tony Stark from that fucking dumb Civil War II comic. Ugh. Yeah, these films are my jam during my edgy tween years. you do you, man. But I wouldn't even think of, as a tween, to think, oh, I'm just going to watch an old movie that's about apes ruling the world. Because, yeah. But then again, what would I know? It's even funnier considering the fact that even back then in the older days, Planet of the Apes had fucking toys. They sold toys in this. All the dark, the grotesque mutants, like unmasking themselves, the inhumane treatment of the humans in the first movie, and all the grotesque and dark, bloody mess that happens in this movie. But then again, I guess I really miss toy companies before the 2000s. They were unafraid to even just make anything out of action figures. Hell, they fucking made action figures out of John Carpenter's The Thing, for God's sakes. Like, these guys had no chill. They thought, ooh, property, let's make action figures out of it. But nowadays it's like, oh, well, we can't, because it's going to cost too much money. How much are, and most of these are just collector figure companies that do it, and economics is, like, a bitch. Well, that reminds me, I wonder what the economics is even going on in the Planet of the Apes. Do they actually have, markets? Do they have trade? What do they trade with? What was their currency? These are questions we don't ever actually even get to explore, not even in the new films, I don't think. I think maybe the Burton film tried to explore the avenue, but I couldn't for the life of me even remember that. It's like, if you're going to go to the point to make this franchise out of making a world that is built around apes rebuilding civilization from the ground up out of nothing, there's avenues you gotta explore here. Like, you got your religion and your science covered, and of course the grotesque and inhumane way of, like, making hunting out of sport out of the humans. But, like, what about how do they thrive? Do they have jobs? Do they get paid for jobs? Well, clearly they get paid for jobs, because Zia Zero at one point mentions that her new pitches would get her like more money than Cornelius. But what are they being paid with? And apparently in the later films, they like certain people get paid with nuts, but is that the currency, or is that what humans get served? Oh, thank God.
Back. Sorry about that. So what were you on about?
I developed to the point where I just talk about, like, how can we never even discuss about economics in the Planet of the Apes? Like, what did the apes use as currency in their time? Because they had to have trade with something. Zero mentions that she got paid for, like, her new promotion. So what are they being paid with? What is the currency exchange right here? And even Ian agrees with me. Like, if you're going to go to the point of building this lore about apes building a new civilization out of nothing, you gotta cover, like, the thing that's making the world spin in that point, or it's giving the apes purpose to go get out of bed, go to work, and do what they're doing.
I'm guessing,
and have something to, as recompense for it.
And we know they're very religious, because I still love hearing that funeral in the when Taylor's running away, where they're talking about how he was a good love gorilla and a defender of the faith, and mentioned there was never an ape he never met that he didn't like. Stuff like that.
Oh, I'm sure they say that about every ape they have.
It becomes a fugitive movie, and there's a bit where, and we met Armando.
Oh yeah, I also devolved into talk about how it's like baffling that this franchise always seems to turn dark at every single damn corner, and it, despite that, toy companies still managed to produce merchandise for this franchise.
Even an animated series, I might add.
You gotta be pulling my fucking leg.
No, there was an animated series that happened in the mid-70s as well called Return to the Planet of the Apes. Featured Dr. Zaius and everything like that. And also featured, like,
oh my god.
It was an interesting, interesting animation. There was even a TV show spinoff called, you know, it was a Planet of the Apes TV show that had two other displaced astronauts appear into the,
Oh, of course, because God only knows, we keep sending our space program out to God knows where, only to be bounced back from the edge of the universe and thrusted back into the future.
And it was kind
of
like
one single flight.
It was kind of like Gunsmoke meets Planet of the Apes, because these guys would go from town to town and deal with the issue there. Humans do live in equality with apes, but there's still, you know, fierce gorillas after them and shit like that. So it's like, but yeah, these guys are just trying to find a way to get back home. And it only ran for a couple of episodes, I think 13 at most, or one season. But it is on disc to own the complete Planet of the Apes TV series.
And my result of that ramble was that I missed toy companies before the 2000s. Like, they had no chill. They just saw a property and were like, we must make toys of that right now.
They won't make toys that don't even appear in the movie.
I'm pretty sure I told you another time ago, they made fucking toys out of John Carpenter's The Thing, for God's sake.
Are you sure those are old toys and not recent toys that were made for modern collectors?
And even if they weren't, the toy companies back then were still wild to make, like, anything.
Aliens, Predator, Terminator, Rambo, all movies you'd be crazy to take a kid to go see at 6.
Oh, Billy, be sure to bring your Rambo, like, rail bullet gun with you while we go to Grandma's, okay?
And, well, hey, at least it was Rambo in the 80s. If you take a kid to go see John Rambo, they ain't coming out right after that. Guy gets turned into literal paste by a 50 cal in that one. One of his fatalities in MK11 comes from a direct scene from John Rambo that isn't exaggerated, where he literally just sticks his bare nails into a poor guy's throat and just... Anyway...
So, where the hell were we?
Oh, yes.
Haslam being an asshole.
And Armando being the one shining spot in humanity that is totally chill with the idea of apes one day ruling. If it is man's destiny to be dominated, let it be dominated by such as you. And he loves talking about Saint Francis of Assisi, a lover of all animals, which comes with him. So,
I mean, I'm sure he'd be chill about the future. I mean, he's not going to be around. He's going to be frozen in 1993 and just chilling out in space.
where he'll eventually, he still loves animals in the future. I mean, he loves his weird SETI alpha eels that go into people's ears.
Well, those teenies movies are kind of my jam, I think, because I just lost my grandfather to death, suddenly felt more real to me, and these films helped me process that.
That's great.
No, it doesn't sound creepy. Nope.
Another funny thing on that note, one last thing about Khan. I think Khan would have been totally chill with Tribbles. In fact, I think he would have found a way to weaponize them.
I don't know
why,
but I would believe you on that one.
Although, I believe he would find a way to weaponize them even more so than they already were, just being nuisances. We shall starve our enemy by dropping a Tribble on the planet, and let them deal with the food supply and nuisance, and we will come in and exterminate them ourselves and be hailed as heroes.
But it's already all of them. Sir, right?
Just the ones that just the ones that cause problems. But yeah.
Anyways, back to 73.
Yeah. Oh, so it does lead to what him also being proud of the fact that his circus is the first circus to have a chimpanzee bred in captivity.
By the way, did he ever actually give that chimpanzee a name?
It did have a name. It did have a name, and it was the child of Haley. I think her name is. I forget the name of the female chimp, but there's a bit where, yes, they do. Zira does end up getting enough labor pains that this baby's coming. It's coming out, and even Derek says he can't help but feel for her in that scene. Like, oh, this is too much when you can hear her going through labor pains and everything.
Really?
Yeah, you were a little overwhelmed by her just being like moaning, like, oh, Cornelius, yeah, like that. And she's like, she can feel him coming.
I would think it was more wincing at the fact that she was egging on for the other chimpanzee to say mama. Because she's like, she needed something to take her mind off of all this.
Yeah. And yeah, so we do get the little chimp born using an actual chimpanzee, which is always funny. Every time they use a baby, it's just a literal chimp, but small. And they decide to name him Milo after their poor departed friend who was so inspiring and got them there in the first place. Don't get used to that name.
Yes, he was so inspiring, we only knew him for, what, 5 minutes?
Yeah. You know what would have been more... This would have been weird if they only knew him for so long, but... I wouldn't be opposed.
I mean, at that point, they might as well have just named the chimp Brent. They knew just about it, but on screen.
Oh, man, Brent. Oh, gosh. I was going to say, I wouldn't find it too bad if they named their child Taylor after Bright Eyes. Or just call him Bright Eyes.
I definitely know if it was born a girl, they would have definitely named her Nova.
Oh, damn. Damn, dude. Anyway, so there's a point where the gears are turning in her head when they realize that they are going to be hunted down. Even Cornelius tells their few human allies, you know, they're probably going to kill us, so why don't you give us a chance to, you know, kill ourselves on our own terms? Even Dixon's all like, I knew you were going to ask that. So against his better judgment, he does give Cornelius a pistol.
Remember when we had that fun, happy-go-lucky montage of them going out in the town? Getting dressed up. It's almost felt like it was almost going to be like a earlier John Hughes movie.
And then it turned into a 70s movie.
That's got to, like, fucking Death Wish, apparently.
Yeah, it's a 70s movie. Oh, God. I would love a Death Wish adaptation where it's about an ape that deals with problem apes and problem humans in town and just does it by his own law. Or even the other apes are like, you're going too far with that hand cannon of yours.
Pregnancy always makes things more intense, doesn't it? Look at this film, Legend of Korra, Terminator 84, comic, and Outlast 2. Or, in some circles, they can make it absolutely look like it's pointless and, like, unharmful, like a certain Star Trek Next Generation episode, or... Avengers number 200.
Oh, Jesus Christ, let's not go there. So there's a bit where... Haslan is telling them to search. He's very smart. Because Armando's all, oh, we were going to take your baby and you guys, and you guys would live in a nice colony in the Everglades. And then Haslan thinks about how if she's pregnant and already giving labor, she won't go too far. So search every zoo, circus, and repository you could find. Or even Armando's thinking, well, shit. I was really banking on that.
Yeah, I just realized Amon isn't really good with his plans.
Oh, no kidding.
In this new year or the next one.
Poor Amon, though. Good-hearted guy, but doesn't really think things through.
He definitely doesn't have the con intelligence. Then again, even with that, con intelligence didn't do him that much good either.
I'm laughing at the superior intellect.
But yeah. Full power.
Yeah.
No! You have Genesis! You have the ship! Impulse
power!
Damn you!
But yes, there's a great bit where they're telling him, don't worry, we'll find the apes someday. Then he goes, oh yeah, well, someday we'll deal with pollution, or someday we'll deal with nuclear war. Everybody thinks we have all the time in the world, but how much time do we actually got? So I'm pretty sure in his eyes...
You know, Heslin, if you actually were worried about that stuff, you would have actually been focused on that more instead of making a damn manhunt on some talking apes.
On top of that, I like how Derek thought, why is Heslin so intent on stopping this future when he or his descendants won't be alive to see it?
I'm waiting for the answer to that, because literally, like, I would learn... I could have an alien appear to me right before me and say, Earthling, I have grave news. The planet Earth will be destroyed by the year 4596. And I'll just sit there and go like, so what the fuck do you want me to do about it? I'll probably be dead before I even hit 3000.
But at the same time, it's that same attitude of, oh, well, we'll be dead before that happens, that leads to careless abandon of, like, the ozone layer or the Earth pollution and stuff like that. I mean, that's why Godzilla has to fight pollution and to get his hands dirty. Fighting a monster that's literally acidic. That was also in the 70s. This year, too. Save the Earth. Save the Earth. Save the Earth. Yeah.
So even in the 70s, we were a bunch of hippies.
Well, that's where the hippie movement really took off.
Oh, right. I forgot.
Well, the 70s were fun, and now I'm paying for it. Every time I get a chance to use that.
That joke always kills me whenever it happens. He's so casual about it. It's like, I guess I don't have to pay that lease anymore.
Like, I knew those drugs were going to come back to me eventually. But yeah, it does lead to, you know, Zira having a moment with the chimp mom. It's funny that they're thousands of years of evolution apart, but so similar. So similar, in fact, that their children kind of look alike. And even Derek was like, oh no. When he realized the gears in her head in that one. And of course, on initial viewing, that looks like such a poignant moment, but then he realized, oh man, they're going to Superman 2 this shit, aren't they? So they do camp out in a rusty ship that Dr. Dixon was going to, you know, rendezvous with them to take them to a safe place, a safe harbor and everything. But, of course, clues are left behind for that detective, that guy with the bloodhound nose, Heslin, be able to sniff out a trail on them and eventually lead them to a spot where they will, you know, he does try to attempt to go up there and tell Zira to give him the baby now, and she tries to flee and she gets shot. And poor Cornelius, he sees the cops coming too. And then he ends up blasting Heslin from the side. But of course, the cops are watching and they just saw an ape shoot a guy, so they figured, well, arm the assailant, take him down. And, oh god, seeing Roddy McDowell just go out that way, it's like, that, I mean, getting shot was bad, but making those, you know, guttural chip noises before, you know, hissing before falling down to a very tall death is just very undignified.
You want to know what's more undignified? Hearing all of that through the baby getting shot.
Oh god, he does end up shooting the bundle, and Zira makes sure to, like, toss away the corpse before she, like, succumbs to her wounds in front of Cornelius, and poor Stevie and Dixon are all like, well, we knew this was how it's going to end, but all hope is not lost until we get to, you know, Armando Circus, where he talks fondly to the chimp, saying, you know, you are a very intelligent animal, so were your mother and father, and that little baby's going, mama, it's a talking baby ape. That ends up revealed being the surviving Milo.
Or as he'll be known in the rest of the movie, Ceasar!
I'm pretty sure Armando...
Yep, it turns out that if most of you who have come to this franchise through the newer movies will be surprised to learn that the character Ceasar actually started on the old ones, specifically starting from Conquest and into Battle. And I'm assuming that they changed the name from Milo to Ceasar due to, I'm pretty sure, I could be wrong, I could rewatch the movie riddled with so many goddamn plot holes and make my brain burst, to see if Armando actually even named the chimp that was actually born of a natural monkey. But I'm pretty sure that the birth certificate that he had laid out, it had the baby named Ceasar. So that was the name that Milo had to take on from now on.
But yeah, another thing to note, this movie only cost $2 million to make. It made $12 million at the box office, so talk about a return on investment. So, of course, that means more ape movies. I mean, especially with a cliffhanger ending like that. I'm pretty sure had it been okay, it would have been a trilogy where it ends off in that uncertain future of that baby ape talking mama saying, are we still destined to go toward that future Heslin was worried about?
The ending would have been what we, as sci-fi enthusiasts, would have called the bootstrap paradox.
Uh-huh. So,
which then leads to the question, where did the apes originally learn to talk?
And the funny thing is that I think by trying to stop the future, Heslin might have just accelerated it, because they said in 200 years' time from the 70s, that's when the whole plague would have wiped out pets eventually, and apes would be sentient enough to be, you know, servants and stuff. But this,
well,
a mere 20
out...
years...
Yeah, so we went for 220, although it turns out there could be some correlation due to the fact that the ship that brought the apes in might have had the bacteria plague that was still laying dormant in the future had manifested into the ship jumping back. So essentially we just carried the plague that killed the dogs and cats to the earlier point in time, so that they would be wiped out sooner.
I forgot to mention this bit in that made me laugh my ass off. Rewatching it again in Escape was when they're trying to explain how the apes can come from our future back to here. And the guy was talking about the painter that observes himself, who paints a painter observing himself. The infinite regression paradox or whatever. And I think I just said, oh no, I've gone cross-eyed the more he was explaining it. I know what he's trying to say, but I'm still going, well, that surely simplifies it. I'm all like, no, it didn't.
But yeah, unfortunately, due to the fact that the apes decided to make a light match and run away method of escaping the planet that was doomed to explode, they unfortunately brought the bacteria that would have caused the cats and dogs to be killed off. So, yay! We've expedited the future!
Although
the future is now!
I don't think they said it was from the ape astronauts. They just said astronauts brought back a plague with them. For all we know, it could have been one of those other ships that bounced around. But yes, point is, in the 80s, dogs started to wipe out, and in less than 7-8 years, they were gone. And people started to... Because it opens up with the faraway future of 1991.
And we see a bunch of humanoid apes and gorillas and chimpanzees walking around being towed by guardsmen who are leading them to tables with pitchers of water.
Teaching them simple tasks with simple commands. Do.
Do.
No.
Do.
So, poor Ceasar, now adult Milo, is coming along with Armando, seeing this ape society where the apes don't look too happy. And everybody's just treating him lower than dirt. He even tells Armando, I thought you told me apes were treated like pets over here. This is slaves. And he goes, well, it started that way. But then people found out that they're intelligent enough to do simple tasks. And, well, instead of subjugating man, they subjugated this supposedly seemingly inferior species. And it's funny because you see, like, demonstrations. Like, you got people mad that apes took simple jobs from jobs people used to do.
So in this timeline, instead of people being upset the AI machines are taking jobs over, they're upset over the monkeys.
It's a different type of
AI.
Well, that's
humanity for you. Different times, same grumps.
It's a different type of AI. Instead of artificial intelligence, it's ape intelligence.
I had a sluggy for that joke.
Anyway, so Ceasar gets to see the lesser niceties of human and ape interaction while him and Armando are trying to, like, set up a circus that's coming into town. And even Armando tells him, listen, Ceasar, you spent too much time with me that you're a little more evolved than your contemporaries. So you don't want to call any attention to yourself. So they go down to town, a town square, where one ape is just getting the tar beaten out of him so bad that Ceasar can't help but outburst, calling them lousy human bastards, that even caught the attention of the coppers. With Armando trying to take the fall, but...
Yeah, this is yet another point where Armando didn't think... Well, no, he keeps thinking of these plans, but it execution, it doesn't work out in his favor.
Well, for one, he said I would have been able
to... The poor bastard always seems to roll a nat 2 every time.
He tries to reason with the cops that it was me, and Ceasar had already run away, so that made him suspicious of the ape. He even told him, Ceasar, if I would have been able to pull it off, yeah, I remember, it's complicated, but you were thinking only what... You were saying what I was thinking, and don't be ashamed. Like, oh, Armando, I'm so... Oh, by the way, I think what... Roddy McDowell was back this time playing his own son, with playing Ceasar, and I gotta say, I think the ape makeup on him really had advanced enough that there's a lot more emotion in him. Like, you see a lot of emotions on his face. I think he's even more emotive than Cornelius or the other apes.
Yeah, you could definitely see why when we decided to reboot the franchise, we decided to have our focus on this ape in particular, Ceasar.
So, we also get introduced to the hierarchy of this place, the apes that all do this stuff, and we meet that the head of this particular city is a governor named Brick, who is exceedingly sing-tunery evil, played by Don Murray.
You thought Haslin was, like, stupid evil? No. He was, like, stupid suave evil. This one is just bombastic barking out orders. It's essentially, what if J. Jonah Jameson had a brain tumor and said, I'm going to run the town my way.
Well, yes. And, yeah. And, like, he relishes in showing man superiority over the apes. And he has his trusty assistant, Mr. McDonald, with him. And he's got his head of security, Culp, along with a few other people at his beck and call, that when they do...
Don't you mean Breck and Call?
Yeah. Breck and Call. And they do detain Armando enough where he says, if I can't talk myself out of this, I'm going to try to clear it up. You just have to go to the harbor, disguise yourself as one of their cargo, and just hide amongst the already big ape population, because it's a lot of apes.
Oh, that was his plan.
Yeah, that was Armando's plan.
I was kind of confused why, like, Ceasar was willing to go into, like, all the midst of that.
It was Armando's idea. He said, I'll come back for you. Yeah. You got to get rid of those clothes because they'll be looking for you. And if they find you and they know you're the intelligent ape, they're going to do worse to you. So he doesn't, like, they'll murder you like they murdered your family.
J. Jonah Jameson mixed with Mel Gibson, Ian said.
Yes, very Mel Gibson-y.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Oh, especially in the last act, Breck really goes over the top, and I love hearing it. But, so Ceasar does have to end up going into the system where he gets an up-close personal view of how the apes are conditioned and schooled.
God,
even Derek was surprised.
There's no denying it. So up until this point, the franchise somehow managed to get a G rating, which, as I noted while you were, like, away from keyboard earlier, it's just so surprising that even despite all the dark shit, especially with, like, having inhumane sport hunting with humans in the first one, or the bloody ass shootout with our heroes in the second one, and God forbid the baby getting shot in the third one, and they still managed to get G-rated. The ratings board had too much chill, because they were like, it's fine, and I didn't say nasty words. It's give it a G rating. Who cares? But no, this movie, there is no way they could have circumvented this plot, circumvent any scene to get as low as down to a G rating. No. The best they could have pulled off is at least a PG. And boy, does it show. Especially with scenes where apes are getting, like nearly ear-raped with, like, bombastic party music because they have to learn how to, like, serve it as if it was, like, a loud club night, or handle fire being shot at them, or constantly being electrocuted with, like, the phrase no being implanted as their trigger of pain.
Yeah. Like, they electrocute them all saying no. They flamethrower them to discourage them going for a banana. Even Derek's like, Jesus, dude, that's a flamethrower.
Everything was rough, but the
flamethrower threw him overboard.
It's like, okay, so there was, like, earlier there was, like, there's a human that was discovered that they didn't get an ape that was conditioned to work with fire. I didn't realize that, when I saw this scene, I thought, so this is how you're conditioning apes to handle fire by literally going John Carpenter on them?
Oh, yes. And, along the way, Ceasar got to meet, while they're passing out flyers, got to meet another ape, Lisa, played by Natalie Trundy, who was Stevie in the last movie, and the Pretty Mutant in the previous movie before. Other than Roddy McDowall, she's one of the few long-running Planet of the Apes actresses to reappear in just about every sequel.
Oh, this is the only one little coy, happy one, where, like, I swear, I think Roddy McDowall pretty much looked at the camera and just, like, shrugged and go, it's a living.
So he turned out to be the best testing ape of all the intelligence tests and tasks. You see apes doing it and screwing it up, but you see Ceasar do it in, like, aces. He passes the test every time. So I think
Ceasar, maybe you should kind of tone that down a little bit. You might be drawing certain attention.
Like, you see one ape wash his hands and show his hands almost childishly about how he washed his hands, but you see Ceasar properly with two fingers taking out the paper, washing his hands, crumbling it up, hitting a... But some of the guys seemed impressed, saying, oh, finally, one of these guys gets it right. But yeah, so just a bit that made us laugh is that when they have to get their best apes for insemination...
Insemination!
They got three gorillas and one chimp, and the one chimp happens to be Lisa, who even Ceasar was surprised by that. His luck. He kind of looks at the camera and shrugs, like, well, when
it's
in Rome.
A living.
When in Rome. One of the few bright spots in this rather bleak movie. So he gets enough attention that he's put up for sale as a prime ape. Oh, I just realized what I just said. I didn't mean for that to come out that way. Prime ape. But yeah. He's put up on the sale block where I went like, oof, if you know your history well, that is a big oof right there where you just put these guys...
Do you get it? If you don't get it, you have a black guy as, like, one of the main characters being assisted to this evil guy. Do you get it? Do you get the subtext?
Oh, yeah, they're a little more overt with their subtext. It's not. I don't think it's subtext anymore. It's overtext. But, he's on the block where they mentioned... I remember when they start the bidding at $800, I'm like... A whole living being is worth more than $800, and even $70s or $90s at that point. But
eventually, Breck decided to take in the bid because, like, oh, what the hell, I'm just gonna have at least a slightly higher, smarter chip, and plus, I might have found the zeroed in target for this.
On top of that, we find out that he. Putting a Ceasar in his possession kind of might have put him in the eyes of the operation to hear everything that McDonald and Breck had been doing with the city. So they kind of gave everything to Ceasar on a silver platter by subjugating him when you think about it. I do love that bit where he says, well, why don't we put up the tradition that my wife used to do where we let the ape land on a name and that's their name. Tough luck for you. You landed on Buttercup.
But of course, Ceasar, being a clever little monkey, was able to find his name in there.
And he goes, oh, you guys named yourself after a king, huh? But sometimes he botches a few tests, so you can still keep up the idea that, yeah, I'm not as the smart one, you think. But he goes on assistance with McDonald, where... And sometimes McDonald would be the more sensible, like, maybe you shouldn't be worried about this. Maybe you should be focusing on that, with Breck's paranoia telling him, no, this is what we got to focus on. This Operation Achilles, with reference to our Achilles heel, our weakness, that these our ape disobedience stuff has gone up. And they say, well, we got to put, when Ceasar screws up, they say, maybe we should recondition him. And he says, are you kidding? If we reconditioned every ape for every single tiny screw up, ape control would be overwhelmed. Which gives Ceasar the idea for
Also, during this, we see that McDonald is a little bit more kinder in discerning Ceasar for if he made a mistake. He say, more this.
Yeah, because he's
like, he doesn't say flat out no. It's like it's that one actually.
Yeah, he'll be like, and he'll say do, but more like in a rather helpful do way rather than a commanding do. I guess because he could probably say maybe in some way McDonald kind of sympathizes with the plight of the apes, but he's not like even one of the guys taunts him like, "What are you, some type of ape lover?"
I also did laugh whenever when Breck was talking about like subjugating, and it's like, dude, you do realize you're talking about this to again, where's the subtext? There's no subtext. It's overt text.
Yeah. And then, of course, Ceasar does start convincing the other apes to do a little more acts of disobedience and to...
Oh, but why, though?
Oh, yeah, wait. Yes. Eventually, Armando is given a chance to go free, but they notice there's a discrepancy.
Yeah. You'll be free to go here. He just needs you to sign this waiver here. It says your testimony was entirely true, and that your monkey was definitely not the one that was talking.
Yeah, okay, so, I'll do it.
Oh, that seems simple enough.
Not without the authenticator.
The authenticator, what the?
It's some type of psychological machinery that would allow anybody to spill their guts. Think of it maybe like a modern polygraph or whatever.
No, it's essentially the lasso of truth.
Uh-huh. It's
like you could try it, but the words are going to be... escape your lips are going to be the truth whether you like it or not.
Because he mentioned earlier how he never heard of Cornelius, because they mentioned that you're looking for that baby was believed to be killed, we're looking for the child of Cornelius and Zira. I said, well, I never even heard of them until this meeting. So when he says, is it true you only met Cornelius that time? He's like, no.
Unfortunately, Armando lets it slip that yes, the monkey that he had and that he had the cops looking for is the one that can talk. Was in fact the one that did talk back during that outburst that led to all this kerfluffle happening. And yes, is indeed the child of Cornelius and Zira that they had feared. And so they decided to pay him in kind and get ready to arrest him. But of course, Armando takes the long drop and a short stop.
Yeah, I don't know if he escaped knowing it was that high. I think he did try to run away, or maybe he did know it was...
Oh, crap, I didn't think that through!
But yeah, and then...
And of course, my personal favorite of all time, man falling off of a cliff. No!
Or you could say that he got made into, if you want to do Frank Miller's words, he got turned into street pizza.
At this point, he probably is.
Well, that was a tall building, but even Derek was surprised. Like, we knew he knew Armando wouldn't be around in the picture long because Ricardo Montalban was an and in this movie. And we all know the rules. If you're an and, you're probably not long for the movie. You're either a high die or you die.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Just ask Bryan Cranston.
I can't remember if they didn't show his body. They just like, well, that's
the circus owner died, and poor Ceasar overheard that. And this is where some of the best
poor bastard acting felt so broken and torn. It's like, he's my best friend. He was my father.
Everything for me.
And they took him from me because of what I am. And I'm a damn dirty ape. Well, damn the odds then.
Yeah, but anyway, it's like that howl that Roddy McDowell does in Anguish is pretty well done. It's kind of silly, but I would compare it to the second shout that Al Pacino gives in, okay, maybe that's too far, in Godfather 3, where people say, I wouldn't call that an example of good acting, but I was just thinking of it all of a sudden for some reason.
I never actually seen Godfather 3.
So, that's when the revolution starts to, like, take shape. He'd be looking at apes, like some sort of specter, harbinger, watching it all as they would, you know, be doing their job, but then they'd be, like, dropping trash, or they'd be taking knives while cleaning dishes. Like, they're doing stuff, getting ready for a revolution.
And what we didn't even bring up earlier, when Ceasar was brought into the rehabilitation facility, when he was brought into a pen with the banana given to him, I always joked, like, oh, is he going to have his mother's disdain of bananas? Or, nope, I guess he's going to piece him off and give him to his cellmates. Which is kind of a smart move. It's like making friends in higher places sort of thing.
Yeah, and then, of course, it comes to a head where they're getting weapons, they're getting kerosene. Or Ceasar would be taking the notes the humans are doing, and they would see their ape disobedience levels going up, which is making McDonald even more, I mean, Breck even more paranoid. He's even telling McDonald, he thought I was crazy, huh? But they're willingly, you know, sabotaging stuff. I'm telling you, something's coming. We got to round him up and find this one ape fast. The evolved ape is among us. And then
you start to think, oh no, they also learned that one of the shipments had a really weird mix-up here. Or Borleo, where the orangutans came from. Except there's a chimpanzee in there, and as y'all know, chimpanzees are not in Borleo.
Oops. So, and Breck started putting things together, like, wait a second. So there's a part where he tells McDonald, give me my Ceasar back and take him to the center. We might want to question him. And he says, I sent him out, even though Ceasar's right there with him. So McDonald seems to cover for him, and he even says he's just frustrated by everything. He just says, I wish there was some way I could understand. He could understand me, and Ceasar decides to go, oh, to hell with it. I'm almost caught. He talks to him.
Plus, he's already lost one, like, good human. At least this one has been, like, cruel or mean to him. It's like, well, this whole society is just gonna crumble, so what the hell? I'll just add one more.
But, oh, man. Just even McDonald has the face of, like, oh, shit, you're the one they're talking about. And he mentions...
But he doesn't have a face of, like, fear or an undulating dread.
It's more like amazement.
Myth. Some myth.
The only myth I see is the myth of human kindness.
Which is bullcrap, considering the fact that he was literally raised up by one kind human, so...
Well, yeah, but that was shattered that by the city.
So if he made that statement, you might as well just said, fuck you, Armando.
Yeah. So,
you and your stupid thoughtfulness can go to hell.
Yeah, but McDonald does try to convince him. He says, hey, the only way this go forward is the only option to my people is revolution. And he says, you know that's suicide, right? This time. Because he even says, how long has it took your people to get to where they were? Because at least Ceasar was well-researched in human history to probably know that was an issue.
And McDonald's probably like, touche.
Yeah. And of course, that's when they do get caught by Culp and his forces eventually.
Oh my god. I know I, like, when I worded to him while we were watching, like, I can't look. No, I literally did have to look away for this because it was just inhumane to even watch. They literally torment Ceasar to make him say a word. Any word at all.
And he begs for them to have pity on him while he's, you know, just on the table writhing.
I, I, I was literally, like, hoping that Ceasar would, like, have fortitude to stay quiet, to just act as the dumb, like, ape that they mistaken for. But the pain must have been so intense that, like, even when he's, like, breathing his last breath, he's like, Fritzy. And I just go like, no, you out of yourself, man.
Even God, Breck's all like, it. I knew it. You were the one that I'm looking for under my nose this whole time. So they decide.
Well, okay. we got a monkey tied up in an electric chair. Let's go the full 11.
So thankfully, McDonald decides to think he can get out of here. And they make a joke saying maybe he doesn't have the stomach for this. But no, he went down to the power room that doesn't have no guard, thankfully, and was able to just shut off the exact table so that Ceasar can just play dead.
Oh, he actually, wait, where's the charge? Wait, there's no charge. They're going to try to kill me another way.
And of course,
although I feel like he went dead, he went limp too soon. I feel like he should have added like at least 4 seconds of screaming before he just like cut himself off and fell.
But of course, they didn't double tap or shoot him in the head. They just figured, yep. We got him. He's done. Even Breck's all like, well, that takes care of that.
Anyways, what's my next meeting, Nancy?
Yeah, so, of course, that's when Ceasar does his, you know, strangles the one guy who was probably just closing off for them and just has to get out there and tell all the apes who are gathering knives and equipment, the time is now. And they end up storming Ape Central, which also had other apes that were in there. That were already, you know, overflowed from, because they mentioned how they have no extra ape control units because everybody's too busy dealing with the disobedient apes that they sent for reconditioning. Because remember what McDonald warned about, if Breck sent every single one of them back for a little infraction.
It's here where we should mention that there's a little bit of a discrepancy here. See, there's actually 2 versions of this movie that's circulating around.
Ooh.
So there's the theatrical cut, and then there's the unrated cut.
And the unrated cut goes a little more far. In fact, some of the scenes made it into the trailer. But like when they're storming Ape Reconditioning Center, there's that guy with the flamethrower is holding them off. And in the theatrical version, he just gets tackled down. And they grab it, and they light the guy like the firework on the 4th of July.
I think it was even like up close too, because yeah, they had to really sell that this guy was being burned. And not only that, but even during the attack and defense across the city that's under lockdown and curfew, and the guards are like shooting monkeys, you can see more blood, you can see more headshots, you can see like humans and guards getting cleaved by like knives and like fucking like choppers that they use to cleave like ham hocks.
The big hatchets they have, they almost look like Klingon bat lips almost.
And yeah, it's really merciless, and it was kind of a stomach to watch the poor pawns, as I would mark these unfortunate apes, to like be
mowed down,
shot down. Like they just went down like paper dolls being pushed down by dominoes.
But, oh man! And then of course it leads to them going to command center, where Breck tells them that we gotta take them out. Yeah, like he said, like the quote he mentioned, say this could be the end of human civilization. The world belonged to a planet of apes. That's one of the over the top lines I love. By the way, I read this, that Don Murray would rehearse some of his lines in German to get that Nazi feel, the severe feeling of the Nazis, with the way Breck would roll the apes. Huh.
How about subtext? That? What's that?
But, yeah, and hell,
you might as well just bludgeon everybody with a hammer and says slavery and Nazism is bad.
And then of course the the director said he went for like news footage style, like chaos with the way the apes like storm each other, pile over each other, go up against riot police, stuff like that. And it does feel that way because there were the racial tensions that happened only a decade prior.
Yep.
So it does culminate to a really great moment where Ceasar storms the area or command center with Breck. And Governor Breck even like orders him to shoot all the apes inside the command center, even though the apes aren't participating in the revolution.
Yep. Breck has gone full bye-bye. He has gone full entire supervillain. He sees all apes as equally bad. Damn the eyes, we'll just like make servants out of horses this time.
And then that's how you get My Little Pony.
Wouldn't that be the fucking twist?
Yeah. So, and this great moment I love is when Ceasar says, "You," he said, "you're dead." He's like, "No," and he talks about how, "Why do you hate us so much?" And he brings up this speech about how inside every man is a little bit of ape, and that ape is like the reminder of the dark primal need that man has had within himself. Basically, we hate you because we see too much of ourselves in you, and you're that beast we have to slap down. And Ceasar almost beats him to death right then and there, but decides, "Nah, we'll take you out to the public square."
Yeah, sure. My response to hear that speech is taking a quote from Kurt Russell. "Are you crazy? Is that what your problem is?"
But yeah, so you see cops getting chopped up, bodies just being prepped. This is an unrated cut, especially just being prepped before Breck to say, "You know, look what we can do. Look, this is an example of our power." And even McDonald is all like, "Hey, this was not how this was supposed to go." And this is one of the best scenes in the whole
movie.
Oh yeah,
by the way, Caesar made sure to tell the apes to leave McDonald alone.
Yeah, because I think he wanted to save a special fate for that guy. And poor Lisa, with the bullet wound, is watching all this unfold. And this is where we get to the differences, but it does have this amazing, stirring speech by Rhodey McDowell, where McDonald confronts him, saying, "This way of revolution is destined to fail." Saying, "Well, what you saw happen here will happen in all the other continents. Other apes will be following suit." And he's talking about, like, with knives against guns and flamethrowers against kerosene. He's like, "Oh, no, no, no. Yeah, we're going to be just wait for you guys to destroy yourselves. And that's when we will be able to come up there and take over the place and make a place with no people. We will, you know, build our own societies, religions, and armies and dynasties." Basically telling us, you know, "Your time is over. Our time is now." But you know, Rhodey McDowell said it much better. I'd rather not recite it, but, you know, we all know it. But the best part is...
You hear a snippet of it at the beginning of this video.
Yeah, it's very great. But the whole speech is just amazing. And Rhodey McDowell gets super passionate. Like, his body language gets very thrashed, very manic. "Our own religion, our own armies." He's just, like, basically, he's kind of become Chimp Hitler at that point, if you want to go that far. Again, subtext.
Yeah, and after that speech, yeah, Heslin gets executed by the apes.
Breck.
Well, it's Machado. They're the same, like, prejudiced asshole.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but...
And we end the movie with the city burning in the background and Ceasar looking on with the, malice in his eyes before he goes, "My God. What have I done?"
Yeah, you can tell it's an uncertain
end movie. Now, isn't that a great film, guys? What did you guys think? Look at the test audiences.
That was just too much for them. Too violent, too gory, and too... I mean, the guy just pretty much throws humanity under the bus, even though one was two have shown kindness to him. He's thinking, well, you two are okay, but, you know, fuck the rest of your people.
So, yeah, the guys realize, I think we just did an oopsie by making our main hero that we focused on become the bad guy. I mean, granted, it would have made the movie a lot more dramatic, a little bit more poignant to the fact that violence against violence, and now we've just begun this whole circle of violence all over again. But, again, we did follow this guy for the entire movie. We know that his parents wouldn't really wish that upon humanity. They honestly were starting to find humans to even just like ones in their time, like Nova, to be like unassuming, like a little bit more nuanced than how most ape kind or even humankind have like pretty much like blacklisted them. So it would kind of be a disservice if he was kind of against what his parents were about, or Amanda was about. It would just like literally make the guy unlikable.
And the thing is,
so
when you think about it, the original ending had has Ceasar go full Muad'Dib, huh?
Oh yeah, it's the Paul Muad'Dib that we see in Dune Part 2.
Where revolution is not. In fact, some people kind of now that the original ending has been restored, people will say that maybe that defangs it a little. But at the same time, like you said, I would like to think that the ending of that one dovetails directly into the original series where Zaius and the apes are on the top in the way they are. So I'm pretty sure that they wanted to rework it. They cut out some of the more violent headshots and the flamethrower, and they gave a second addition to Caesar's speech, which is still very good. But the problem was they didn't.
They couldn't bring Roddy in to do the makeup or set the whole thing up again. So they had to
edit really around it.
Do some splicing edits. Which, to be fair, it could have been worse. They could have just did the whole narrator thing again from beneath the Planet of the Apes.
But then Caesar stayed.
That would have made the whole thing fucking laughable.
But then Ceasar stayed his hand, providing an uncertain but bright future for ape and humanity. And that's how the narrator
That's great, narrator, but from what we gathered and saw for ourselves, I'm gonna have to say I'm gonna call your statement bullshit. They had to get Roddy back in ADRW's lines. Although, before he makes that second speech, there is one poignant thing that happens. So, going back to Escape from the Planet of the Apes, Cornelius explains that like the whole actual start of the apes rising against the humans was the fact that there was one ape that was like flat out against all this like subjugation and decided to retort back the same statement that he's heard humans over and over again. The ape known as Aldo looked to his humans and said no. Cut to Conquest of the Planet of the Apes, and we have a different ape that said no to what Ceasar was going to seemingly implement. We have Lisa, who, despite being subjected and being abused herself, still understood that there had to have been at least a line where we should not, like, act as the monsters just to feel better about ourselves.
Mm-hmm. And the thing is that one part of the speech I do love is when he says, "What right do you have to do this?" "Oh, the slave's right of rebellion." And he says, "But I'm a descendant of slaves, asking you to show humanity. But as you can see, I'm not human." Just the way he gives me vibes of Mad Hatter with his text in that one. We're not human, but we could afford to be humane, where he talks about how if man is to be subjugated, it'll be subjugated with compassion and kindness, like what McDonald and Armando has shown him. So cast out your hatred.
And I did admit, like, that speech is nice and all, Caesar, but there's a building still on fire behind you. But nobody died from that.
But you gotta admit, though, it is awesome hearing him say, "Tonight you have witnessed the birth of the Planet of the Apes." And they all cheer. Even though the original implication of them rifles going up a dial was when they beat Breck to death. But Breck is alive in this one.
Alive to see that his assumptions turned out to be wrong. Yeah, mostly.
Because if you look at the way he stares at the apes in the original ending, he had a feeling of, "I knew this day would come. You guys..."
Well, might as well just do it. Yeah. But I hope you have enjoy it like the beasts you truly are.
Yeah, he had that look on his face, and then they bring it down. But then in the other one, you see him like turn around at Ceasar looking all like, "Wait, he's sparing me?" Yeah.
Now, there are some people, especially after the unrated cut did make circulation, they feel like the theatrical kind of undermines like the fact that Ceasar spent all his time to bring about this revolution. He's literally has apes dousing kerosene across the streets so that they'll be ignited across. So he's had apes like jumping guards, like taking them down with guns against guns and riot shields, using cleavers and hammers to like beat them down to submission. And then he made that huge point of speech that like the human days have finally like turned about because of their fear and hatred, and that they only just doom themselves to this never-ending loop even sooner than they expected. And then he makes this plea of peace and harmony. But having seen the original recently, I do feel it's a lot more stronger if Ceasar did take the stance.
You did say...
Because...
Yeah. Go on.
No, you go on.
You did say it reminded you of a very famous superhero story involving when to use force and when not to.
Yep. The Superman versus the Elite, based on the adaptation of a comic book story of What Is So Funny About Truth, Justice, and the American Way.
Love that.
Where, in that story, Superman is faced with the pastiche of rogue, like, superheroes known as the Elite, who are super powerful in their own way, but they use their powers to get to the direct root of the problem. They don't, like, oh, sure, they'll be around to help, like, clear, like, debris from people in war zones or get them out of danger if they're stuck in a tunnel that's nearly drowning. But they're also quick to punish those that caused all this, and they would go directly to political leaders and like flat out say, like, well, all your wars and conflicts are over, your leaders are dead, so have a good time snogging about yourselves. And of course Superman is against this type of superheroism and the fact that he challenges them to a direct conflict. And most people, even like Superman at one point, believe this, that there is no way he could be able to defeat the Elite because he's not as ruthless. He doesn't get down and dirty as them. And so it kind of almost seems like it went down that route where everyone expected that Superman gets his ass whooped by a bunch of like dark, greedy heroes because they have no morale. And then Superman comes and shows that what real power that's left unchecked is goes on them.
Ooh, yeah.
And it's grim, dark, and gritty. You see this like symbol of hope look like the most destructive force of nature that you could find. I'm pretty sure this is a lot more like scary of a Superman image than most dark like Injustice or Brightburns or Omni-Mans that are all like other forms of dark Superman pastiches you could think of.
True.
But then at the last minute, like as like the leader of the Elite, like stayed out, like, well, go ahead then. You're no different than us then, and now the world is gonna see it. Yes, they did see it. They saw how blank and ugly and murky it was. It almost scared me too when I decided to cross that line.
Mm-hmm.
Luckily, I'm not like you. And it turns out Superman just completely faked the whole thing just to show them. To pretty much scare them into the fact that, like, yeah, this is what you would have expected me to do, but I still didn't do it because I can think the problems through instead of going for the blunt trauma.
Yep.
And that is what Ceasar is going for. Because just much like the name that he picked out in English language, obviously because it's a name that Armando gave it to him, Ceasar is no name for a king. And in most iterations, a king is always seen as this figure that will always think for his people, but also think of the future for them, and what is the best course of action. To think of the way to find a way to stop conflict and end it in the best case scenario. And he lives up to that namesake right there in the theatrical cut.
Because there are two Ceasars in history. There's the famous Julius Ceasar, who is known for some of his more aggressive tendencies that led to his downfall from his own power. And then there's Augustus Ceasar, who was a more successful emperor than his namesake, probably.
So yes, I prefer the theatrical, especially since it actually gels well way more with the next movie, which had to have happened because the original ending didn't happen, so they were falling off the theatrical, and okay, now my eyes are getting crossed.
But it makes sense, because imagine if you saw the unrated ending about how there's no place for humans, and then in the next movie you see humans living side by side. Like, well, so much for that.
Yeah, it turns out it didn't work out as he had hoped. We needed actually more stable hands, so anyone that's got like an open resume, don't feel discriminated.
So obviously this movie made gangbusters despite the upgrading and the touchy subject matter. It's still...
Can I also say, this of the original Legacy Collection, this is actually my favorite movie of the bunch.
Nice.
Like, I think it's one step over the original, because of course the original has to do it. I think the thing that held the original back a little bit, in my opinion, is the fact that we had to go through that whole, like, coincidence that poor Taylor got mute, and of course he, like, instead of being a smart person to think through and actually, you know, try to, like, you know, sign, like, the pen and paper to Zira, we're on camera right now, you can see me.
Yeah, I can see you doing that.
So, like, this, he's just going out, like, aggressively reaching for it. It's dumb actions, but it's smart movies. But here, you're seeing literally what is going to be the big stepping stone that leads to what the original intent of the franchise was going to lead up to. And it is certainly a lot more dark and heavier than we had any implications for.
So, it was 1.7 million, which is amazing given all the apes they had on screen, but it was 9.7 successful at the box office. So, of course.
Oh! It says, I changed my mind. This is probably my favorite outside of the original and the Ceasar trilogy.
Really now?
Yep, that's what Ian said.
Oh, dang, yeah. Because he started with, Escape. I guess I was pointing out Escape's,
problems, and then me explaining the more weight to the theatrical ending of Conquest. Yeah, well, I'm glad I helped convince you, bud.
Well, you said so. Like, a good king knows when to stay his hand. You could always, exactly. Yeah, you could always have an Aerys Targaryen, or you could have a Viserys or Aegon the Third, or first. Ian knows exactly who I'm talking about, because. The Westeros has a fun history of kings based off of English lineage. But,
So, leading to the battle for the Planet of the Apes. And boy, did a bunch of get tanked here.
Oh my goodness, this one... It had the same director as this one, but apparently the writer, even though he was credited with this, was kind of too sick to be there for the beginning of the process. So they had some other guys take a crack at it. People who probably hadn't seen the other ones.
Although, to be fair, they still managed to put out a very decent end to the cap to this original Ceasar trilogy.
Oh, yes. They said this. Paul Dane had done the script for everything, but he was too sick to start the project, so they had the writers of The Omega Man do the writing for this one. And so they had Guy come back and rewrite it, and he altered the ending a little bit, which the writers were a little bit, like, miffed about, but yeah. So this one is setting up a whole new ground about, you know...
So it seems like it's take place 27 years after Caesar's initial skirmish with his revolution, and apparently that did ripple waves of other apes to beware, but then of course humans decided, like, well, alright, rocks fall, everyone dies, let's drop the bombs.
Yeah, so here's the thing, we get introduced with the lawgiver being the narrator in the year 2166, which, or something like that, which, if you remember the original movie, it said that Taylor's report was before he went to sleep was in sometime in the year 2000. So, maybe that future's still coming. Who knows? But we have the great actor John Huston playing the voice of the lawgiver. And it's funny because he gives it an almost biblical sense. In the beginning, there was the ape and man. And they would, you know, live together in friendship and harmony, looking for greener pastures after the bomb, so stuff like that. Like, just really great narrator for the, playing the lawgiver, an orangutan, who is nice to see an orangutan in good standing after, you know, guys like Zayas and everything.
Oh, we're going to see a much better one in the same movie, though.
Oh, God, you're right. That's like one of my favorite guys. We'll get to him. But, yes, so we get a recap. In fact, we get a lot of recap of stock footage of the previous two movies, which if you're watching in a marathon, you're all like, we just saw this. But movies took a while to come out in between times. They didn't have home releases, so it's like, hey, just in case you didn't remember what happened, here's the Birth of Ceasar and everything. So we are seeing that, yes, Caesar's trying to run a little community that has apes and humans living alongside, where the humans are teaching apes school for proper speech. Of course, we have the upstart gorillas led by Aldo, who doesn't want to go to school. They want to ride. He's played by Claude Atkins, who does a great job playing this brutish, dumb, blunt instrument in Aldo. But it's funny how he takes the name from history that Cornelius mentioned. But I told Derek this. For some reason, Claude Atkins' performance as Aldo gives me strong vibes of Bautista as Drax and other roles of that ilk.
Yeah, also it kind of sounds like a little bit more of a brutish, dumber version of Ursus.
Oh, man. Ursus is... Yeah. So that's why... If you're going to put Aldo in a competition with the other generals like Thade and Ursus, he probably would be at the bottom, but it's not without his charm.
Yeah, part of the reason why he goes down the bottom is, we'll get there when we get there.
I think there's a lot of dumb reasons why, but he's not as charismatic as someone like Ursus, or as cunning as General Thade or something. He's just a gorilla like a bull in a china shop. Cruising for a fall, you might say, because there's a great bit where we get to see that Cornelius is the son of Caesar, is one of the children at the school that is rather fond of the teacher, where they're going through the lesson of ape law, of ape must never kill
shall
ape.
Shall not kill ape.
Mm-hmm. But should ape ever kill man, Aldo asks. So, yeah, you know that Aldo is among those guys who just does not like...
General Aldo, as yeah. They'll often correct you.
Refer to him by his title. So, they do chase after him when he rips apart Cornelius' gift to the teacher by calling Ape, and it's not kill Abe. And Aldo's is all messed up, so he decides to tear it up, and oops, the
teacher said no! He said the N-word. No, not that N-word. We're talking about the word no. Which, because, we generously learned that the apes got electronically shocked whenever they hear the word no, so they'll always associate that word with that pain.
So, of course, this gets taken to Caesar, where he mentions how, no, the teacher shouldn't be messed up, and that Aldo, you and your gorillas will repair the schoolyard.
Yeah, because it seems all they ever care about is wanting to ride horses.
Yeah, and fight and all that stuff. So Caesar is a little bit beleaguered at this point, because it's like, it's very hard to keep both societies in check with their differences given their history. Plus, you know, was it right for them to kill evil? Stuff like that. Like, watch my parents. He's most of it's his sense of isolation of being the only highly evolved, intelligent ape, given that he never got to know his mother and father. But he does have some good humans at his side, like the brother of McDonald, his younger brother who works in archives. I found out that the original actor, Kyra Rhodes, did not return. He declined a chance to return in
Really? I thought it was the same guy.
That's his brother.
No, I mean, like, I meant the actor.
No,
which is why I was confused when, like, he said that he was the brother of McDonald. I was like, well, what's the point of that? You're literally the same guy, aren't you?
Yeah, it's another actor. But, you know, it could have been a roadie.
Well, the actors must be fucking twins themselves, because, God.
But, yeah, I think people says they could have just done a roadie and say it's still the same McDonald. No need to go with the whole brother, but it's a little convoluted to make him the brother. Because what kinship does the brother have with Ceasar other than the years they lived together? Because it would have been more powerful if it was still, yeah, the same McDonald, given that he's helped him guide through the struggles, given his own viewpoint on human history and all that stuff. So, I know, but that's one complication.
But I guess they had to go with that because, like, as they said, that this is supposed to be 27 years after that fateful night.
And this guy's a little more fresher face than the other brother, so yeah.
Yeah, although he still had to work in the archives, so he was, I guess he was working as a teenager?
Possibly.
I don't know. Fuck it, I'm just gonna have to use this quote. Space is warped and time is bendable.
That's our first Mystery Science Theater reference. I was gonna use the other one, whoopty shit, when you mentioned the advanced rocket. Whoopty shit. But yeah, so McDonald being in an archive says, yeah, I can actually take you there. You can listen to the words of your own mother and father. He's like, I can't see them. They're dead and they're in another future. I can't actually see them. And he mentions, well, the idea of recording is a way that he can hear their voices. So,
okay, I guess you might as well just go to the Forbidden City.
It's the only place there is where humanity's already nuked each other, and Governor Breck was among those taken out in the fall. Which I found
good
out
riddance.
Don Murray was approached to reprise his role, because remember how I said it felt like having Special Agent Culp be the leader of the mutants and rebels in this one kind of felt like a downgrade? Well, originally the script was written for the other fellow to return as Governor Breck, but he declined. So, yeah, that's why it was Culp instead.
Which at least is fitting, because ultimately the true villain of this movie is not in the guise of a human, it's in the guise of a gorilla.
Mm-hmm, with all those, you know, being fed up with Caesar's kumbaya attitude. So when Ceasar and an very eccentric but very smart philosophical ape named Virgil join him. Virgil, by the way, was played by the great musician Paul Williams, actually.
Really now?
Funny enough, Paul Williams himself would go on to be a voice actor. And both him and Roddy McDowall would appear in a certain series about a Cape Crusader as villains.
Wow.
Yeah, Roddy McDowall was Mad Hatter, of course, Drivis Tech. And Paul Williams went on to be Oswald Cobblepot, a.k.a. the Penguin. And you can kind of hear...
I was wondering why his listed voice is like... I don't know why I'm enamored with his voice. Like... but it's like very, like, got like a pompous ground to it. Yeah. Why does it sound familiar?
Virgil is definitely better than Dr. Zaius.
Fucking Zaius.
And I regret not putting Virgil at any point in my thumbnail. Oh well.
Well, you still had him in the opening.
Yes. Yeah. Like I said, though, he's a forward-thinking orangutan. And so he'd be the one that would know about radiation, because they're talking about we need to read the radiation levels before we end up, you know, like losing our hair and shit. So there's a great sequence that's in the I found out by accident my version was the extended cut, because Derek was ahead of me by a lot, and I'm like, I'm still over here, and there's extended dialogue scenes and added scenes to it. So one of the dialogue scenes is the very smart way Ceasar keeps order by storing away all the armored weapons guarded by a guy who tells a lot of riddles.
No, not just saying riddles. Boring riddles.
Yeah.
The ones that would, like, really rile up certain dumb gorillas' minds, or would probably, like, throw off any other wayward monkeys, or maybe even humans, from accessing it.
It's Lou Ayers playing Mandamus. But yeah, but so he does give them the weapons. They go to the Forbidden Zone, where they're convinced nothing could live there. If, even if it did survive, it wouldn't be recognizable. We find out that there is indeed.
Didn't we kind of cover this in the second movie?
Yes. So we end up going into the Forbidden City, where we find out there's a security system set up there, and there's still humans living in a supposed dead zone, but living in the hell of radiation. Well, we got Agent Culp, as mentioned before, succeeding Governor Breck as the new governor. And he's got, you know, his faithful follower, Alma, and another interesting fellow named Mendez, who might be a descendant, an ancestor of one of the primary mutants in Beneath, named Mendez. And this is the guy who seems the most interested in peace, which I found interesting that it gets expanded upon more in the extended cut. In fact, I think the extended cut benefits the mutants much more in this version than the much more faster-paced theatrical ending, the theatrical cut.
Yeah. Also, no, before we actually recorded all of this, I actually decided to go revisit a rewatch battle, because when we were watching it, I'm sorry, dude, I really do think I actually kind of nodded off a little bit in the middle of there, because I definitely don't remember there being a council meeting where the humans arrived and the gorillas were like, discrimination, racism, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to sit over here instead of sitting with these filthy things.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, there's some great moments, too, and you get to also hear that Culp is a sore loser, saying, you know, if this battle goes wrong, go ahead and nuke Ape City with the ultimate bomb.
Oh, no. They didn't.
They did.
Oh, God, the fucking thing again? The Alpha and Omega? Why did you build this fucking thing?
Yeah.
Who thought it was smart? This is breaking up there, the dumbest science right there since, like, Superman World's End, having twin clones of Hitler.
Of course. Don't you know anything about science? But, yes.
God.
But, oh yeah, so they do go to the Forbidden City. They find that there are mutants there, and they end up shooting in self-defense to get away, but then the mutants are convinced, well, the apes will come over here to finish us off. Let's go to their home, find out where they live, and take them out. And because it's a three-day...
And Mendez is like, are you sure? Because from the cameras, they look like they're just doing it in self-defense. I mean, we were kind of the assholes that just shot at them. It's like, no, they were armed. Why else would they want to be armed? It's like, or they, we're kind of going into a radiated zone. God knows, like, we've already had to deal with rad roaches ourselves, so...
For all we know, they could have found Deathclaws from Fallout.
Or whatever the fuck shit is in the Metro series.
But yeah. So, of course, they send a scouting party to find the Ape City. And because it's a three-day journey, Ceasar will be away. Oh, but... Derek did make a funny comment where he was listening to the recordings and testimony of Zero
Meridius.
And he made a joke saying, "My God, I look just like my father. I even sound like him. Are you sure I'm not a clone?"
Like, no. You just got your father's best qualities, that's all.
Yeah, but he hears that...
Besides, cloning would be a completely different beast altogether. Let's not get into that.
Yeah. But, oh man,
You don't have the patience to run, like, what, how long does it take the Spider-Man Cloak Saga, like, 4 years to run?
Oof. So, he does hear from Zero's testimony that, yes, the gorillas do end up destroying the Earth, and, Virgil keeps comparing time to a highway, saying how each different divergence leads to a different point in time, so if you can possibly know what to avoid, you can probably change it. So even Caesar's all like, I think I know what I want to change. So you must avoid that future where man is doomed to fight ape forever until they destroy the Earth. So, of course, while he's away, poor Cornelius is, you know, being the optimistic, pernicious ape that he is, and ends up overhearing all those plans to overthrow Ceasar and take out all the humans in the village.
Hey, guns! Guns are power! If you have guns, you have the power! We must have guns to have power forever!
Oh, God. So...
Like I said, this Aldo... You know, it's funny. Like, thinking back to the original Cornelius' speech, the fact that... it was said that it was Aldo that said no to the subjugation, like he led the Apes to uprise over his oppressors. I'm pretty sure Aldo is essentially the dark future that we would have had. Had Ceasar not been born into this timeline, had he not been the one that would have had more fortitude to be smart enough to get into action sooner, like, we would have had Aldo be the one that incited all this. In fact, later on in this movie, we get Aldo does say a very notorious no when Ceasar says, like, let the humans out of the corral. And I was like, no!
Uh-oh. But ape could say ape no to other ape, but human can't say no to ape. So, unfortunately, you know, like it says, he does end up cutting the branch that,
that Cornelius is on, like, cornered on.
And he ends up getting gravely injured. Not dead, but injured enough that when Ceasar returns home,
it's a devastating blow for sure. So, and he was, and he literally was just at the war council meeting say, like, okay, look, guys. I know that we did have that big, huge revolution uprising. We had fun knocking some human heads in after they tortured us and maimed us and electrocuted us and all manner of subjugated torture and slavery. But I'm thinking we should probably not do that to them too, you know? So who's about that?
So, of course, he's so preoccupied with his being at his son's bedside, that Aldo's able to round up all the humans and raid the armory. So, of course, that doesn't end up well.
It says, this franchise loves killing kids, that's it. Oh, and it won't stop.
Oh, you're right. Yeesh. But yeah, so Cornelius does unfortunately pass away with Roddy McDowell giving such a tender performance, because he keeps telling Cornelius, because he's so small, one day you'll be as tall as a king. Which gives me Mufasa Lion King vibes for some reason.
Oh yeah, before that we also had this, before all of Cornelius getting into that accident, there was the talk where Lisa is, like, concerned that Ceasar is preparing to get into a conflict with the mutants in the city. It's like, I thought we were going to be away from all of that. We were going to stop all this, like, anger and violence.
And then she even said, I don't want to remember my husband. I want to enjoy him now.
And also, like, going about, like, what's the difference between mutants and freaks that you grew up with in your Amano's circus? The freaks are a different breed. These mutants are mad. Not formed.
But yeah, Lisa sure got adept at talking ever since she said her first word.
Well, it's a lot happens in 20 years. Goodness knows, like, in 20 years' time, we have, like, humanized apes.
Mm-hmm. And they're all wearing the same clothes from the first movie, conveniently.
But to be fair, like, the materials are kind of at a limited standstill since, you know, like, big cities kind of got bombed out.
Well, yeah, but it's nice that they actually reuse. It makes it more connective tissue. So, of course, the Ceasar's a little upset about the whole human corralling thing, and that's when the mutants do their big stand. And this is when we get the title, The Battle for the Planet of the Apes, which is a skirmish with a school bus, a couple of motorcycles, and a jeep with a motor shell. The director wanted to go much more bigger, but again, this only had a budget of $1.7 million. Are you kidding me?
In $70?
Yeah, where the Conquest and Escape were made for much more than that.
So, yeah, the way we described it doesn't sound like it's a lot, but, well, they managed to pull off the statement that it's set the size of it, it's what you do with it that counts.
What's funny, though, is that there's a lot of exploding tree houses, but it's literally just the one tree house they blew up filmed from different angles.
Hey, if it works, it works.
Yeah. So, Culp is determined to take out Ceasar and the rest. So, there's a great moment where they have to retreat. And, of course, they think they kill all...
Oh, yeah, we also have that scene where the gorilla watchman, one of them gets blown up to bits.
Jesus, yeah.
I'm so glad this franchise is so consistent with showing cruelty to animals and blowing, like, incessantly to blow up people on screen.
Well, yeah, so, there's a great moment where, you know, he thinks he's got Ceasar cornered, and he even recognizes him as the same Ceasar from before. Oh, I love that bit when Culp is looking through the recordings, he's all like, yep, that's Ceasar, and that's McDonald's brother. I don't think I know the orangutan. What's so funny about the mutant scenes is just how chill they are. Also, how everything is filmed with Dutch angles in their world, which he says, Derek says, is always used to like create an area of unsettledness and everything.
Yeah, it's a whole less is more kind of thing. To be fair, like, we're in a future where, like, again, big cities are bombed out, and one of the cities, the Ape City, is just kind of, like, starting from nothing, really. It's just basically, like, stables, and, like, the schoolhouse is literally just at the outside underneath the big tree. Mm-hmm. It's very, like, limited.
Of course. So, they do manage to surprise the mutants with Virgil throwing a grenade at them while they got Ceasar cornered. And then they blow up. They end up pushing them back. But you get that great line from Roddy McDowall as Ceasar yelling out, "Now, everybody, fight like apes." So they manage to push them back. And if you watch the theatrical cut, the mutants just kind of bugger off. But if you watch the extended cut, Aldo and his crew manage to trap Culp in the bus and just take everybody out.
It's literally just an execution.
Even Derek's all, oh god, when he saw it.
It's like overkill. Like, they literally smash in the bus windows and just, like, shoot them in there. Like, it might as well just be shooting fish in a barrel.
And, of course, they come back where Virgil had deduced that Cornelius's fall had not been an accident, and they even told Aldo that, hey, you kind of messed up. Ape has never killed Ape, not even a child.
Oh, then the shoe drops.
And that's when Ceasar realizes, wait.
No, that's...
It was you.
You killed my son.
And they're all doing the ape won't kill ape, and there's a great moment where the humans are confused, going, what's going on over here? And he says, and McDonald smartly says, I guess you could say they just joined the human race.
And of course, it ends with the slightly anticlimactic face-off between Ceasar and Aldo, which they probably did a lot better with the Dawn of the Planet of the Apes with Coda.
Yes,
Cobra. But even then, it's still kind of fitting that Otto gets taken out this way. He goes out the same way as he made Cornelius fall. And in a way, it still leaves Ceasar to be a little bit more clean-handed, considering the fact that all he did was defend himself from being struck, and all he did was just push, like, Otto off balance and let gravity do the rest.
So, yeah. And there's a...
But even then, I'm pretty sure it still left the intention that if he didn't, like, smartly deal with that and had to really, like, put his defenses up, that, yeah, he would have probably made Aldo really pay for that.
Mm-hmm. And they keep pointing out the whole movie about how humans need an equal seat at the table. And he says, well, no, humans have a propensity for violence and anger and all that stuff. And then
Aldo was not human.
And that's when he realizes, yeah, there is a lot more alike than there are different. And this was cut out of the theatrical cut, but in the extended, we get an extended scene where Alma's not heard from Culp and says, I'm going to do it. I'm going to blow everything up. And then...
No! Don't! Culp was, like, demented to not lose. He was willing to not only just blow up Ape City, but he would blow up the whole world!
Where Mendes says that we could... maybe learn to venerate this and honor the peace that this bomb has given us, and how maybe we'll be something beautiful someday. Basically setting up the mutants in Beneath.
Yeah, it also kind of makes their religion make a little bit more sense, see the fact that we use, in modern day, nuclear arms threats as a way to keep World War III from not happening.
A deterrence.
Although goodness knows, it always keeps closely happening.
I'm pretty convinced that World War III will not be fought with nukes, because I don't think nobody ever wants to be the one to push their hand on the button. I think no one is mad enough. That's why in Terminator they made it the AIs did it, because they'd be cold and calculated enough to say, "Eh, no skin off our bones, let's blow everything up, even if it destroys our hard drives." Whereas man, I think, is like, do I really want to go down in history as the bloke who pressed the button?
Yeah. Really, all Skynet really needed was to play a game of chess with Matthew Broderick. Then we would have probably been saved.
But yes.
Strange game. The only winning move is not to play.
But like you said, though, yeah, that. The bomb became worshipped in the Apes society because... You think you had a point about the mutants? That you understood why they worshipped it?
I honestly thought that they were just kind of nuts to worship something that was... That if someone had spilled coffee on the console, it would have blown everything up.
Oops. But yeah. I do love that setup, and I that's why I prefer some scenes in the app extended a lot more, because I think it dovetails nicely into the theme of the end. So... They decide that they want to destroy the weapons, but they decide maybe we should still keep it for defense and wait for the day when we will no longer need them.
The greatest danger is the fact that danger never stops.
Mm-hmm. But I love that. Like that. And I love how he even calls Virgil a wise ape. We were a wise ape, Virgil.
And then we cut to later with the lawgiver. 600 years. And it turns out, yep, it looks like Caesar's promise to have humans and apes be equal among each other did come to fruition.
But will it be a everlasting peace? Because even the lawgiver says, we still wait for the future where man and ape will no longer need conflict and weapons. And they even ask, well, who knows the future? Maybe only the dead. And there's a great bit where you see the child ape and the human child like still kind of have some little strife, but it's still peace. And even this is what the original writers objected to, that the first writer from the original series, Paul Dehn, when he was called in to rewrite 90% of the script, and he added that ending where you see the tear falling from the statue's eye, which they thought was silly and stupid, but I like it. But the writers who wrote
it's divergent. It's either like Caesar knows that it's like, well, it's gonna be all pointless. We're all gonna die anyways. So it's kind of sad to know that these kids are just listed on a hopeful story, and it's just all gonna be moot.
Or
it could be the fact that yes, he actually managed to do it. He managed to change the course of history. It will never be as doomed as Taylor had to witness it.
Now imagine if Taylor crashed in that society.
I'm pretty sure he would have been looking around, seeing a bunch of humans in like strange clothing, just as much as the apes are. He'd also have seen apes, he was like, "What the heck is going on?" And they would have probably thought that he was going a little bit nuts. He's talking about having crashed in a ship. It's like, oh, great, we got another one of these ones. Okay, let's just take you to Dr. Zira. She'll give you your tests and give you the thumbs up or thumbs down if you need, like, more treatments.
I'm pretty sure Landon and Dodge would have lasted longer.
So definitely.
Yeah, but what do you think, personally, of the crying statue?
I prefer that it is the happy ending, because... we've changed time far so much, as I pointed out. It's no longer Aldo that says no first. Lisa even solidified that with her no statement in Conquest, to go from like being violent and aggressive to, like, seeking out peace with one another. And the fact is that, like, they have already learned that apes can be just as cruel as humans can so early on. So they knew for a fact that, well, I guess not everyone's perfect. So we just had to take the good ones where we can.
Yeah, so I also see it as Ceasar is very happy. But it's so funny, this is called Battle of the Planet of the Apes, and you have, like, the poster be a gorilla holding up an American soldier while armies upon armies clash on an open field, which is nothing like the actual movie.
Although I guess you could say it's implied that's what happened, because goodness knows that extended cut, I might as well have that happen in there.
But yeah, like, I think because they had a much more bigger scope in mind when they originally wrote it.
Ian also agrees that the statue was signifying a happier end.
Well, after all the bad endings we've had in the past, it's about time we had an ending that was a little more hopeful.
Yeah, so that was the original five movie trilogy, saga. Because we also had two, Saga. The Legacy Collection, as it would be collected in Blu-rays and DVDs sets. And overall, it's definitely got its ups and downs, doesn't it?
It is, and on top of that, Battle was the last Apes movie that that the original producer A.P. Jacobs worked on before he passed away. He passed away not long after this movie released.
Maybe that's what Ceasar was actually crying for.
But yeah, so that meant that for a while the franchise had sputtered out and was okay, and at this point we were in for a sea change, because 4 years down the line, sci-fi would become the new hit genre thanks to a little space fantasy movie about a boy, a girl, and a galaxy at war.
I don't know, that doesn't sound like it's going to stick. Pretty sure that movie with the creepy aliens going to do a lot better than that.
Oh, and then you got the Truth, Justice, and American Way being personified by a man you can believe will fly soon.
Yeah, I think I'll rather wait until they adapt Howard the Duck. That's other super what's-its is not going to go anywhere either.
Anyway, so it would put the Apes franchise on ice. It did live a little longer on TV for a little bit and merchandising, and it remains one of the most seminal classic franchises in movie history and definitely among Fox's catalog. So, naturally, down the line, things would be gearing up for a reimagining, or a remake, sometime maybe.
Or, whatever the fuck this thing is.
Yeah, so we'll get to that in more detail when we talk about the attempt to bring the apes back on screen, and probably the most frustrating film in that it does a lot of things that went right, but it also does a lot of things that just go so, so wrong. Namely, in the head department.
And then it also does the one, what the actual fuck is this supposed to signify?
Oh yeah, we'll talk all about that more when we revisit next week to talk about Tim Burton's The Planet of the Apes, the one and only remake to this franchise in an attempt to restart it before the Ceasar trilogy.
So yeah, but it's kind of be weird to kind of talk just about the Tim Burton movie on its own.
Yeah, well, obviously.
Yeah, might as well just like toss in like a someone trying to capitalize off the idea of a world or civilization where ape evolved and running things after man.
Anyway, I might also recommend that if you do like these movies, definitely buy the Legacy set, because one of the biggest bonuses is it includes the disc behind The Planet of the Apes, which is one of the best documentaries I saw on the subject. And it tells you about all the work that went into each of the films. It's not as comprehensive as Empire of Dreams, but it's pretty close. And
oh, Ian says there was consideration in the 80s to do a legacy sequel where Taylor's son would lead a human uprising against the apes.
Well, I'll look into that. There was a version where Oliver Stone was involved. There was a version where Arnold Schwarzenegger was involved. But again, we'll go into detail of that when we actually talk about the movie itself. I'll just say right now, all these past five movies at least tried to say something. Maybe some of them hit you a little over the head more than others, like Conquest, but the subtext was always there. And I think...
As long as you didn't think too hard.
Oh, God, yeah. If anything, it's kind of funny how much stuff in Battle and Conquest made it into the later films, including Burton's films to some extent. But, yeah, we'll go ahead and talk about that in detail next week. And any more thoughts you want to give on this original five movies?
I will say, so, aside from the classic that obviously stands the test of time and goodness knows, it's literally one of the last few sci-fi's that is literally untouched by the curse of the current time, in which case the future that we see in the media is little more than a fizzled reputation, where we lost 2015, we lost this year to what their sci-fi equivalents are supposed to be. So Planet of the Apes, the original, can get to enjoy about, I don't know, like another millennia before it's like, well, I remember the year 3955, where we blew ourselves up. That was a weird cleanup job we did.
Mm-hmm. So,
but I am like definitely surprised at the fact that such a silly idea premise to try to keep the franchise going, to milk it, and like with so many plot holes that it still end up introducing one of the most compelling monkey characters in like sci-fi, to the point where Matt Reeves would look to actually bring that very same ape back to be the lead for a future reboot.
Mm-hmm. And there was also the fact that I think they described Conquest as Spartacus with apes. I think that is an accurate description. I think of the three films we saw, that one is easily the strongest. I love Escape for its escapism, of course, and it's a little more lighthearted nature. Armando's great in that, and of course the apes having a good time is actually quite fun. The bleak ending does kind of like sit a little unwell with some people, but I liked it. But Conquest was amazing from beginning to end, even though there's a few things where you go like, okay, but it doesn't really follow that part hard under scrutiny unlike other things. And Battle was well-intentioned, and it's not as awful. I think if we had to rank the weakest film of them all, like from the bottom, like just in terms of like production value and idea, I'd have to give it to Beneath, mostly because the first half is just remaking the first movie with Brent. It's not till we get to the mutants and all the stuff that things get interesting enough for you to like make it sound
interesting and weird and make you go like, wait, are we even still the same movie?
But it happens well into the second to third act. So I think what weighs Beneath down the hardest is the fact that the first 30 or 40 minutes is just, let's do the first movie again. We even have our own You Maniacs Here on Earth moment.
So they basically did Evil Dead 2 Dead by Dawn.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, so Beneath would definitely be the lowest ranked one. I think then I would put Battle, not because it's bad, but Virgil really helps highlight the movie, if you ask me. And the battle sequences work. But it is a little slow compared to Conquest and the rest, so I would have to give Battle just above Beneath. Escape, I think, is fine where it is, right in the middle. It's got some stupid plot holes in it, but it's enjoyable enough that you have a good time with it till the heartbreaking ending happens. So that just leaves Conquest and the original definitely being in the top two, interchangeable of like great sci-fi movies. So that's how I feel about this whole thing.
I'd rank it Beneath, then Escape, then Battle, then Planet of, and then Conquest.
Yeah, that's not a bad list. Not a bad list at all. And so next time we'll talk about Tim Burton's Planet of the Apes, and after we get past that hurdle, the week after, I'm so looking forward to when we actually finally get to sink our teeth into the future predecessor of this whole Ceasar thing. But we have to get through Marky Mark and the Monkey Bunch.
Yeah, we'll even throw in some weird rando thing in to kind of round out the madness. Right. Something that even MST3K looked into. The weird Japanese spin-off of like this concept, the Time of the Apes.
One last thing. Since Godzilla versus Mechagodzilla had the people from the black hole have ape faces, and also had other people from the black hole have scarred faces, can we kind of count the Mechagodzilla duology as kind of influenced by the apes?
They were influenced by something.
Well, that's for sure. Alright then, well, I think we've rambled on long enough. Thank you all for joining us this long. I'm DreadyCat79, aka Chris, joined by my usual co-host, Derek, aka Dark Neon.
Yeah, who knows what the future holds?